YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on Local Gov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
The October 1st, 2018, 9 o'clock in the morning meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. First thing I'll tell y'all is to watch the time. If you parked in a Town of Graham 2-hour parking spot, you might want to pay attention to the time and don't get yourself a parking ticket. Mr. Boswell has the invocation and Pledge of Allegiance for us this morning.
All right, please join me in prayer. Almighty Heavenly Father, we come to you today with thanksgiving and also with heavy hearts for the folks that are suffering through the losses down east and trying to figure out where they're going to end up and how it's going to work out. God, thank you for all the first responders and all the people that have carried food and are down there just trying to help these people through this time of despair. But we know you can make this work out for all good. God, be with us this morning as we do the county's business and help us to make the right decisions that need to be done. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
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 I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, before we call our first public speaker forward, I'll just remind the audience that we have rules for public speaking on our website. That if you are watching this on video and thinking about coming to make public remarks, that you review those before you come. And we also have rules of audience decorum that you can review as well. So we ask that people make themselves aware of that and abide by those things. So the first public speaker we have signed up is Elizabeth Simpson. And as she comes forward, if the public speakers would please state your name and spell it and tell us where you live, please. It makes it easier on our clerk.
Good morning. My name is Elizabeth Simpson. I live in Durham, North Carolina. My name is spelled E-L-I-Z-A-B-E-T-H-S-I-M-P-S-O-N, Elizabeth Simpson. I'm an attorney. I work for the National Immigration Project at the National Lawyers Guild. That's a national organization. I work remotely from Durham, North Carolina, but we have attorneys all over the country. What we do is we provide technical assistance to immigration attorneys, to community organizations, and to local elected officials. And our community partners here in Alamance County have asked me to be here today just to clarify some of the legal aspects of the 287G agreement. Some have said that this program is necessary for law enforcement purposes, that it's necessary to fight cartels and that sort of thing. And the fact of the matter is 287G cannot be used for local law enforcement purposes. It is only for enforcement of federal immigration law. The fact is the sheriff already has access to FBI and Department of Homeland Security databases, and he can run those numbers, run those fingerprints for anyone he comes across who comes into the jail and is arrested. He cannot, but the difference is he right now cannot enforce immigration law and cannot interrogate people about their immigration status. However, through the detainer process, ICE can do that themselves at their own expense, at the own federal expense. Right now, ICE does that and ICE uses its own personnel. So if he does get the 287G agreement, he'll be incurring local costs to do what ICE and what the federal government otherwise would do. So it's a difference in who pays for the immigration enforcement. The 287G program specifically prohibits local law enforcement from using the program for local law enforcement purposes. And unfortunately, it'll be opening up to liability. You already know what kind of liability you can incur, the kind of attorney's fees you can incur because of the 287G program. And other jurisdictions have learned that too, unfortunately. And we have advised local law enforcement on how to avoid those costs. We also, unfortunately, have litigated those things as well. If you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer them or I can sit down.
Have you addressed anybody that's got 287G currently, i.e. Charleston, South Carolina? Mm-hmm. Or give me your experience and the exchanges you've had with them.
We have not worked with Charleston, South Carolina specifically, but with other jurisdictions that we've worked with. We talked to them about how the program is only for enforcing federal immigration law. And this is something we've worked with Charlotte about. And I know Charlotte has recently decided to exit the 287G agreement because they found that it is too risky in terms of legal liability and because it also opens themselves up to kind of alienating the Latinx community.
Well, just an addendum to your opinion about Charlotte. Mecklenburg County was the first one in the state of North Carolina to have it.
Yes.
And what caused that to change as of now is a sheriff's election.
Yes.
And the sheriff came from Municipal Police Department, Charlotte, and there's a big record nationwide of the municipality officials, police chiefs versus county sheriffs, county, mm-hmm. non-municipal, supporting. And this guy comes over, I'm not knocking, I'm just giving you the facts, but if that sheriff's election had not turned out the way it did, Mecklenburg County would still have it, or
That's
would
right.
still keep it.
And we've worked with the new sheriff there, the sheriff-to-be, if he is eventually elected in November.
Right.
And he is worried about liability, and he is worried about alienating the community. So I think those are very valid concerns that Alamance should take into consideration.
Thank you for your
Thank you very much.
honesty on it.
Who exactly do you work for?
The National Immigration Project at the National Lawyers Guild.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Great. Next on the list of speakers is Phil Smith.
And I apologize to the chair if I was out of line in my question.
Mr. Sutton, I know better than to tell you if you're out of line.
She asked, were there any questions? That's what I did. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Phil Smith, P-H-I-L-S-M-I-T-H. I'm a Burlington resident and business owner in Elon. The 287G program, when first implemented in our county in 2007, did nothing more than to create fear and mistrust among our Latino neighbors and cost all of us taxpayers an estimated nearly $1 million in legal fees. Re-implementing this program now that we know the detrimental effects, to me, makes even less sense than it did in 2007. I want to live and operate my business in a safe community. I want to let my neighbors feel safe and secure to call upon local law enforcement when they need them, and selfishly when my personal property or business property is at stake. If members of our Latino community do not trust local law enforcement, then crimes could go unreported, and then we, you, me, my business, your house, your business, your family could be less safe. A clear majority of law enforcement agencies across Alamance County, across North Carolina, and across the country have declined participation in 287G. And to me, the reason is plain and clear. They know that in order to protect and serve the entirety of their communities, they must have the faith and trust of the entirety of their communities. They know that when any segment of the community has no faith or trust in their ability to protect and serve them, that population will not engage them. There's a simple reason that only 3% of counties in the entire United States participate in this program. They know that with 287G, crimes go unreported, crimes go unsolved, and actual criminals go free, while law-abiding citizens, residents, and guest workers can be harassed and held at taxpayer expense. They know there's a huge liability of violating Fourth Amendment rights and facing lawsuits that cost taxpayers even more dollars. They know that at the end of the day, it makes their communities even less safe. Just last week, I heard from members of our local community, immigrants seeking a better life for themselves and their families, who were targeted during the previous 287G program in our county. They still live in fear of local police. They do not call 911 for any reason, and they do not report when they see crimes committed or have information that would be valuable to officers in solving crimes. One business owner would not even report when his own business was burglarized strictly because he was afraid that he could become the victim or the target of law enforcement instead of receiving the services his tax money pays for. I want my neighbor business owners to feel safe. I want them to feel safe calling local law enforcement when they're victims of crimes or when they see something happening on my property. I believe that makes my business safer and my community safer. I want my neighbors to feel comfortable calling police, whether for themselves or protect my property. And as a business owner, I want employees and customers to feel safe traveling to and from my business, not to feel like they could be stopped and harassed or interrogated simply because of the color of their skin. If the 287G program comes back, then my house, my business, my community will be less safe, and our tax money will pay the tab. Thank you for your time and for your service to our community.
Thank you. Right, Mr. Nelson.
Greetings. My name is Bruce Nelson. I live, I work, I own businesses in Graham and Saxapaw, North Carolina, and I'm a taxpayer. As because I'm a taxpayer, I have questions. First of all, I've been in business 50 years, and I've been taught in those 50 years to look at risk and reward and cost and benefit, and then make appropriate decisions. Those require data and judgment. You've heard from two of my colleagues that have cited facts and figures, and I agree with what both have said. The fact is, participation at 287G will cost this county taxpayer dollars. At minimum, you have to send somebody to Charleston, South Carolina to train people for 4 weeks. You pay their per diem, their hotel costs, their travel costs while they get trained. When they come back, you pay the salaries while they administer functions that belong not to the county, but to the federal government. Why should I pay dollars into Alamance County to pay for federal government functions? And it'll significantly increase the risk. This county had a bad history of risk last time, and this participation will increase that risk. So the big question is, why should my dollars pay for federal functions? Second bigger question is a bigger one. Why hasn't 287G been included as an agenda item? Why am I limited to 3 minutes? The county attorney's on record stating that you as the commissioners have to approve this. I spoke to the sheriff earlier this morning. This isn't personal with me, with him. I don't think his position should be able to bind this county to potentially hundreds of thousands of dollars of costs and future litigation costs without all of you opining in and saying, I agree and I don't agree. And we have an open forum in which we discuss it. Facts and figures are presented. The county sheriff has said that participation will help him protect us from hardened criminals, violent crimes, drug cartels, and other illegal activities. I trust his judgment. His department does a great job in this county. But if it's so significant and so helpful, then ask these questions in a public forum. Why do only six counties in North Carolina out of 100 participates in 287G, and one's about to drop out? Six counties that border our county do not participate, including Guilford County, which shares the same I-40, I-85 corridor. Why not? And finally, only 76 of 3,007 counties in this nation participate in 287G. That's 2.5%, to be exact. Why so few? My conclusion is, as a business person, could it be possible that the total economic and social costs plus the high probability of future legal costs exceed the potential benefits of participation? Thanks for your time.
Thank you. Do commissioners have any responses?
I do. I want everybody in this county to know that this is a country of laws, not of people. We don't make the laws, but we have to enforce the laws that's on the books. If you don't like the laws, you need to leave the country.
Wow.
That's the way I feel.
Wow.
Wow, my ass.
Wow again.
Does anybody else have a remark?
I'd like to ask the two business owners, do you support doing what is required by the federal government as far as checking out employees that you hire?
Say that another way.
That's about as clear as I can make it.
The documentation that they are here as they're supposed to be.
What's the process where you check the Social Security number and so forth?
E-verify.
E-verify. Do you support E-verify, sir?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you do it?
Yeah.
Okay. What about the other gentleman?
I filed an I-9, which
do you do E-verify?
I do not.
I do. I file the I-9.
Is there a reason why you don't do it?
Which is the same thing we do. That's our partner.
I know very few people. Yeah, it's small businesses usually don't do e-verify.
I do I-9s.
Yeah.
Okay, so you don't do e-verify?
No, I do I-9s.
Okay, I thought you said you did e-verify.
I clarified that.
Okay,
I do
thank
I-9s.
You.
E-verify is only required if you hire more than 25 people. Right?
Okay. It's required, but it could still be done.
Some other businesses usually just follow.
You still could do it, though.
It's an easier process.
Will you accept that you could do it, though?
I don't think you can.
Yeah, I don't agree with that.
But no one is in violation of any
okay.
laws.
Okay, let's tighten it up a little bit and have comments, if we could, by
I'm
the commissioners instead of discussion with
them. I have a question, and I guess this will be to our sheriff. And I've heard a lot about this, and he and I haven't actually spoke about it personally. And my question is, where are we on the process of this?
Right. I have a contract sitting on my desk. I have not signed it yet. And it has to go. We're going to go before the board if we choose to do that.
So can I ask a question to that then? Is that contract then approved by our attorney to your satisfaction?
He sent it back to him. That's how he wanted it.
I sent it back to him, and they refused to make any of the changes that I requested.
So you're still with the position that you wouldn't recommend us signing or approving that contract?
Well, I would prefer to discuss that in an agenda item.
Yeah, I think it needs to be on the agenda. Let's go ahead and talk about it and go from there. Because, I mean, we have groups coming. I'm just, you know, what I read in the paper, thanks Isaac for telling me they're coming this week. And I think we need to put it out in the open and discuss it, because I know I was there the first go-around, and it wasn't a fun experience.
And I would echo that. I mean, I wasn't on the board during the first experience, but I do agree that it puts us at a great deal of risk, liability, incurring legal costs. There are a lot of advocacy groups that are looking at us very closely and just waiting for a misstep. I personally think this is a federal matter, and I really wish that the federal matter could be addressed. I hear economists all the time speaking about the economic benefit of having the immigration population in our country, whether they're documented or not. And they say that there ought to be a way for those who are undocumented to get the proper documentation.
How about
more
the
easily.
Laws, Bob? How about what the law says?
Well, again, this is federal law, and the law needs to be changed. But we're not compelled to enforce
that's
the federal
right.
law.
That's
a voluntary program, and very few counties are doing it.
This is a country of laws. You liberals need to understand that.
Except for assault survivors.
Let's not. Please, from the audience.
I agree with the comments about the impact on safety by getting back into this. Most immigrants are here because they left really dangerous and terrible situations in their home country. Many came on visas, and they overstayed their visas. By and large, they are a law-abiding group of people. Data shows that they're more law-abiding than people who were born here.
That is not true. The statistics does not prove that.
Mr. Lashley, you let Mr. Bird finish what he's saying.
There is a great deal of economic benefit, I think, to our community with the Latino population, the Latinx, I'll say that, population. And having the 287G program would have a terrific chilling effect on all that economic activity, not to mention the benefits of the cultural activity that exists with the Latinx community as well, that benefits our children and all of us, really. So that's all I'll say for now.
Mr. Lashley, do you have anything to add?
No, I've said enough.
All right. Well, I have some things to do. If everybody else is finished, then I'd like to speak briefly on this issue. There's so much misinformation in the community about what Alamance County wants to do with 287G. And I think the reason that we will eventually, if it is timely, when it is timely, when the sheriff wants to be heard on this issue, then it's important for law enforcement to come forward and explain clearly to the public what it is they want to do. My understanding from speaking with the sheriff is that he wants to do the 287G program in its limited jail aspect, not in taking it out into the community to deputize officers, but in the limited jail aspect where he would have access to the ICE civil database to review people who were brought to the jail by a majority of other law enforcement agencies from Alamance County, including the Sheriff's Department, but also including the Highway Patrol, the Elon Police Department, Burlington Police Department, and other municipalities. When probable cause has been determined either by an officer or by a judge who's issued a warrant for arrest, that person would be brought to the jail by that law enforcement officer. So there would be probable cause means that there is reason to believe, it's more likely than not that a crime has been committed, and it's more likely than not that the person is the person who's committed, the person who's been brought forward is the person who committed that crime. Under the 287G model that the sheriff wants to, or has been considering, and he is the elected official law enforcement officer for Alamance County. He is the one who sets the policy. I understand before it said that we approve his budget. That is true, but he is an elected official, and he is the person who is responsible for the safety of the citizens of this community and for the policies that are implemented. So in his experience as a law enforcement officer of 46 years of service to the citizens of the state of North Carolina, he determines that this is the program that he needs. And I am a person, I'm an attorney too, but I'm a person with 0 years of experience in law enforcement. So, person would be arrested for a crime and then brought to the jail, and then they would be, their identity would be reviewed. I understand that through the Secure Communities database, it's been stated that there is access to the FBI and the interstate criminal databases, as well as the ICE criminal database. That is all true. What the sheriff is seeking is the opportunity to have access to the civil database that is maintained by ICE as well. Correct me if I'm wrong, please, Sheriff, but I understand that there's somebody in the jail right now who refuses to give his name.
There's a guy that came in, gave a false name, it was found not to be him, and he's still in jail. And when we briefly had the 287G program, I would say 45% or more that come into that jail gave a name that was not their name, and we found different through the ICE database. Many of those, and some of those, were wanted for serious crimes across the nation.
Thank you. So, one of the things that concerns me deeply is that there's the miscommunication to the public that the Sheriff's Department would be targeting, and I think that's the word that was used by Mr. Smith, targeting immigrants in the immigrant community. And that is absolutely not the case. These would be people who have been picked up because there's probable cause to believe that they have committed, their crime has been committed, and this is the person who's committed that crime. And it's not just the Sheriff's Department, it's all law enforcement agencies that keep our citizens safe. Then the other thing that concerned me was that there were statements that people would be afraid to report crimes that have been committed in the Latin community, that they're afraid to call out law enforcement. And I have two things to say about that. Our law enforcement officers in Alamance County do not investigate people, they investigate crimes. And it's my understanding that when a law enforcement officer is called out to investigate a situation, they do not ask the victims of crime about their immigration status. They investigate the crime. And it would be very useful if the advocates for the immigrant community could help to convey that message, that they investigate crimes, they don't investigate people. And then the other thing that I wanted to say about that is that it would be very useful if the those who advocate for the Latin community could be clear about communicating what it is the sheriff wants to do. Now, a couple of meetings ago, we had some people come and they brought us some pictures from some children. They had made these, I believe, at one of the churches. And at the time, I was paying attention to what was going on in the meeting and didn't take the time that I wish now that I had taken to go back and look at these things that the children made. And consistently, these notes from the children say, we don't want to be separated. My name is blank, and I do not wish for my families to be separated from each other by a law. clearly that has nothing to do with 287G. Clearly that has to do with federal immigration law and the controversies about that. My name is blank. I'm opposed to 287G. It separates families. I want families together in a safe society and happy. Well, I want a safe society and happy too. And I think that a good way to do that is by people who have probable cause to believe that they've committed a crime for them to be brought to the jail and processed. My wish is that you vote against 287G. I want my family to stay together. So when I read these, I was quite, had strong emotions, like many of us do, involving this issue. And my strong emotions rose from feeling like these children have not been given the truth about what their local government wants to do, and that they have been manipulated and brought forth to a commissioner's meeting with information which is inaccurate and prejudicial. So I think that's all my remarks about that. So we're going to move on.
Madam Chair, I feel the need to respond to a couple of your comments.
All right.
So first of all, whether it's a jail model or a task force model is not even available. All 287G programs are just on the jail model. And in fact, our 287G model, correct me if I'm wrong, Sheriff, or the 287G program that we had until, 2012, was, except for maybe a six-month period, was the jail model. It only started off with the task force model. And so we still were litigated with the jail model. And so I think we're opening ourselves up the same with this. You mentioned about somebody being charged with a crime and being brought to jail. Well, it doesn't mean that they did a criminal act just because they were charged. I mean, in this country, I thought we were innocent until proven guilty, so they hadn't been prosecuted and determined to be guilty. With the 287G program, if they're detained here and found that they are here illegally without the proper documentation, then we're going to be compelled to start the process for deportation if the deputy on site feels like they are here without the documentation. And if that person happens to have a wife or a couple of children who are U.S. citizens, that is going to be splitting up families. How can you say that it wouldn't split up families? Sheriff, you just told us that you had the information that you needed for this case that you just stated, but that was without the 287G program, so you were able to get information.
We still really don't know his true identity. He's sitting in jail under a name that was found on him with a different name than he gave the officers.
Well, how do you access it?
Go in there.
How would you normally access that information? Can you go back?
Through he is an immigrant here. It would have been accessed through the database that ICE maintains.
And you have no access to that?
No, sir, not at this point. We do the FBI, criminal history, et cetera, but not the database through ICE without 286.
If FBI and ICE did their thing together, you would be able.
You've got a civil database with ICE and a criminal database, same thing. That ties into the FBI, the civil does not.
So right now, without the 27G, you can't tell if somebody has a civil violation. And this is not criminal activity. It's just a civil violation with immigration law. It's like
No, we didn't. It's not put in. The only thing going into the FBI criminal database is you are convicted of a crime.
Right.
Under that name.
Right. So you can access that, but you can't access whether or not somebody is
crossed the border illegally or whatever. No,
right,
sir.
Right. But with a 287G program, you could.
Yes.
Yeah. And then you would use, and then you would be compelled to use that.
If they were encountered by Border Patrol or ICE.
Okay. Well, and then one other thing is that the research shows, and we hear evidence in our own community, that people are afraid in the Latinx community to call law enforcement in the presence of the 287G program. Anyways, I think a public, putting this on the agenda for more thorough discussion would be a good idea, like we did with the pipeline issue.
So, Mr. Byrd, you support the idea of sanctuary cities. You would want Alamance County to be a sanctuary county.
Well, you're going to have to define what that means. I have no idea what
that would be. Where people who encounter law enforcement aren't deported.
Well, we are not compelled to participate in the 287G program. This is federal law. that we're talking about.
Okay.
And I think that law needs to be changed. We need immigration reform. Mm-hmm.
But you do or don't support the idea of Alamance County being a sanctuary county?
Well, again, I don't know what the
how would definition you define
is. Well, you're the one that's bringing it up.
Well, I just said that I think that if people who are encounter law enforcement don't have their immigration status checked or verified, in the process of verifying their identity. And that's an important point. My understanding is that the sheriff wants to verify people's identity so he can keep them safe in the jail and keep other people safe in the jail. So
I hope that I'm not stopped and checked with my identity other than whatever I have, my driver's license or something like that. If you don't have a driver's license, if I didn't have a driver's license.
So, I mean, think that Alamance County...
Do we want to live in a police state where everybody's being checked for their papers?
I got checked coming up Highway 49. I was at a fundraiser for a school board candidate, and I was checked for my driver's license by the Highway Patrol Saturday night, and I showed my driver's license.
And you were driving, I guess, right?
I was, okay, and I had not been drinking. I was very excited that I was stone cold sober when I encountered the Highway Patrol on Highway 49. But do you think that Alamance County should be a sanctuary county? If by
no more than any other place. I mean, there's lots of counties that don't have 287G. They're not considered sanctuary counties, are they? That'd be the whole country just about.
Well, I like to say we're beating a dead horse on sanctuary cities. I think if you're well read, you know what a sanctuary city is. And I think you know, because you're well read. But let me tell you a story. This isn't totally in line with what we're talking about, but it is, in a way. I was with a family in Winston-Salem over at Wake Forest just a few weeks ago. We were driving through Old Salem. And the girl in the car, she pointed to a building, and she said, "My mother got her citizenship there." And I said, "What do you mean?" She was from Nepal. Is that how you pronounce that? Mm-hmm. Country? North of India, bordering China. And she went on to explain how her mother had to go to Charlotte and be asked the questions that are asked. The studying that she had to do. She was grilled like crazy because there was a divorce involved in the past, and she stayed in there for hours. She came out of the meeting according to the daughter, and she was crying. And her daughter said, "What's wrong, Mama? Did you not pass?" She said, "Yes, I passed." And she was sworn in as a U.S. citizen after going through that on July the 4th of the year that she was made a citizen. And I cannot tell you that it just gripes me that others think they don't need to go through that process. And I mean it. Wholeheartedly. I've met students that were from Romania, lived in the same building in a communist country, came to America 3 years apart, never met each other while they were in that building, had to win the lottery, immigration lottery, to come to this great country of law and order, and didn't meet each other until they got here. And my heart went out then. You did it the right way. That couple from Nepal did it the right way. And we want to turn our backs on that principle. I'll vote for 287G in a heartbeat, just like I did the first time. But I mean that about that couple from Nepal. I shook her mama's hand and hugged her. My mama got her citizenship July the 4th in that building. They did it the right way. And I'm going to push until I die that we do things the right way in the United States of America. And if it makes people mad, it's just going to have to make them mad. I'm sorry. I don't believe anybody can counter that emotion of what it takes to become a citizen in this country. Legitimately. You can't do it. You just can't do it. Why do people from Nepal, Romania, and other countries? I met some Montagnards. Know them well, because of Vietnam. They did it the right way. They did it the right way. And if we don't strive to do things the right way in this country, we're going down the tubes. Just like John Dean told Nixon's administration, there is a cancer eating us up. And I say that cancer is even wider now than it's ever been on social interaction and dialogue.
You're not talking about our immigrant population.
Did I mention
that other than citizenship, what you're supposed to do to become a citizen?
So there's citizenship and there's being in this country with proper documentation. And it's two different things.
Oh, my Lord. I know what you're saying. I'm just saying that I do not support doing it the wrong way. And I would say to you, 287G helps the right way be accomplished.
Thank you. It's not perfect.
I think we might move on to our agenda before these guys are going to be sent today.
Yes, we have a rather large, actually. We have quite a few things on the agenda today. The last thing that I will say on this topic is that I asked Mr. Byrd a question if he believes that we should be a sanctuary county, and I'll answer that question for myself. I don't think it's fair to ask him something that I'm not willing to answer. And no, I do not think that Alamance County should be a sanctuary county. So. Let's move on. If everybody has had the opportunity to review the agenda, if I could have a motion for approval.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second for approval of the agenda. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Next, we have the consent agenda. If everyone has had an opportunity to review that, I'll entertain a motion.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. So next we have the public hearing on economic incentives for Universal Preserve of Kim. The way we're going to do this is first we're going to have an introduction of the project from Mac Williams and the Preserve of Kim representatives. And then we'll have the public hearing and then we'll have a discussion and a vote.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Here's some information that a gentleman from the company is going to present by PowerPoint, but I want to give everyone a copy of it as well.
Mac, let me apologize for what y'all had to experience. This is the kind of stuff we hear every month.
This is democracy in action.
That's right.
Thank you for the opportunity to witness democracy in action.
We'll give you another good example.
In just a minute. So, like I said, we have everybody's got their role to play. And my happy role is to introduce Universal Preserve of Kim as a company considering Alamance County for a new home. The information about the company is going to be presented by the company vice president, Mike Ravitz, and the co-owner of the company with his brother, Dan. Mike is here, and he'll present about the company. Also with Mike is the site selection consultant, Rich Greenberg. The company is a family-owned business in Somerset, New Jersey, looking to relocate, which would mean the entire operation included, which will make it the corporate headquarters as well as the distribution center and operations center. And so with that, we are excited to have Mike here to introduce the company and answer any questions that you folks or the public may have about Universal Preserve of Kim, or as we've been calling it now for the past year, UPI. So with that, I'm going to introduce Mike Ravitz.
Morning.
Thank you for the opportunity to for me to introduce my company. I was supposed to be here about 2 weeks ago, and we were anxiously watching the optics of the hurricane up north, and I just felt that it was the wrong time for me to come down for many reasons. I trust that everyone is doing well and we've moved past that. But I appreciate your flexibility in allowing me to present at a morning meeting. So our company is a family-owned business. We've been in business now for about 55 years, even though it says 50 up there. And what we do, we are a distributor of additives that go into foods, cosmetics, and pharmaceuticals. So I want to emphasize that we are not a manufacturer. There's no effluent associated with our operation, no waste. Essentially, our business is product in and hopefully product out. We are a clean company. Our customers have basically driven us to a more natural, sustainable, green, biodegradable line. I would say that about 35-40% of our ingredients fit into that category. And there are others that are synthetic. And I wanted to just get in briefly. People have a fear of the term chemical. Chemicals can be natural, chemicals can be synthetic. An item like water, H2O, is a natural chemical compound that basically initiates whole life. So, mention that we're focused into the food, cosmetic, and pharmaceutical industry. Each of those markets have particular segments, certain standards that we have to do our business by. And in operating a distribution facility, we operate with the utmost concern for safety and respect for the environment. We have always conducted our business with our customers and vendors with the highest standard of ethics and fairness. And for our employees, we want to create a culture where every staff member has a voice, and we want to create a positive workplace where everyone is valued and inspired. We want to challenge and inspire our employees. We think that's positive for doing business. Speaking on behalf of ownership, we are engaged, motivated, and passionate about what we do. My brother and I are all in on this, and this potential relocation is a very, very big deal for us. So my company offers over 4,000 different ingredients. I don't think we have 4,000 in the warehouse at any one time, but it gives you an idea of the cross-section of ingredients that where our customers come to us on. Like any successful business, you have to have world-class customer service, on-time deliveries, competitive, creative pricing models. Everything that we sell has to go out with a major level of quality care. We want to make sure that our customers, our vendors, and employees fully understand how to handle these ingredients so the products are used safely and effectively. Everything that we do has a certain CGMP, current good manufacturing process. Standard operating procedures are a regular part of our business, while we conform to all federal, state, and local legislations. I'm relatively new to North Carolina, and I'm learning a lot of the history and the geography, and I want to use the term triad. We can't be successful sales-wise unless we combine quality, service, and price. Can't have two, we have to have all three. So, a lot of people think a distribution business is just we're buying and selling, we're traders, but we're not. For us to stay in business for this length of time, we really have to offer value-added services, and I think that we do. We have our own in-house analytical lab. Every product that's shipped into the building comes with paperwork referred to as a certificate of analysis. But what we do, we take it to another level. We test the product in-house to make sure that the inbound material matches what's on the paperwork. We're trying to prevent a problem. If a problem arises, we want it in our facility, not at the customer level. We do a significant job repackaging ingredients, liquids from 55 gallons into 5 gallon pails, and solids and powders to as small as 5 pounds. In our industry right now, customers only want exactly the volume of product that they're going to use for one particular project. They don't want anything left over. Not everyone can do that. We can. And we do it, we repackage within, white room is basically a pharmaceutical standard. So it's as if we're a pharmaceutical company. We're not making anything, we're simply repackaging. Quality control with everything that we ship goes without saying. Our products are have to go out with documentation, with technical support, and sometimes formulation support for the customer. I mentioned earlier regulatory affairs to make sure that we conform to federal, state, and local standards. Customer service is a given. We sell throughout North America, and I will talk a little bit later about why this particular geography makes good business sense for us. We do contract warehousing. We can fill liquids and solids. We do a little bit of blending of food grade liquids. We maintain certain food grade and pharmaceutical grade liquids in bulk. And of course, we have to do all these things and get the products to the customers on time. One other thing I'll mention. Our business is made up of many small to middle-sized customers. For those customers, we provide kind of a one-stop shop, where if they need 5 or 6 different ingredients, they don't have to call 5 different vendors. They can call us and it's much easier for them. It's an efficiency of sale. Why am I here? That is not a picture of our existing building, but that is kind of what our building would look like if we were to relocate. Everything would be racked. That yellow machine would be running between the racks. There would be a magnet underneath the ground, so that is human error proof. They can't knock the racks down. Famous last words. But the geography is meaningful for us, and some of my other slides will explain why it's so important. So here, see that big blob west of the Mississippi? That is a secondary sales area for us. We still sell product through that area, but it's not primary. The area in red is our primary sales area, basically the entire East Coast. And then that green circle, Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina. So I'm here because we want to relocate our business to a geography that better serves the entire East Coast. But we're still able to service our historical home in the Northeast, but we can go north to south and be competitive through our distribution network, our salespeople. So what we're looking for in the facility is a minimum of 135,000 square feet, a site large enough that can provide up to 50,000 square feet additional space, close proximity to the interstates, an available and talented labor pool, reasonable taxes, and for all these things, a target cost of about $15 to $16 million, including the site, including the building, machinery, fixtures, and equipment. UPI would be a very good corporate resident. I want to start with stability. We're a second-generation family-owned business. We've been around for a long time. We're successful. And we're considering this move because our business is evolving. We estimate about 39 new jobs for the county. I mean, primarily, we'd like to pull from Alamance. But there's also an available labor pool between Greensboro and Raleigh that we can pull from. We believe in spending in the community, hiring people, putting money into the community, contributing to a healthier economy. And finally, I want to emphasize again, we do not produce any waste. We promote a clean, healthy workplace and environment. So the building, the picture that you see is within, it's the Southern Spice Building within the Mebane Industrial Park. The back of that building near the green grass, that's kind of a temporary wall, which if we were to choose this location, we would push out and we have room for expansion. But the Mebane facility is a very attractive site for us. And I'm happy to entertain any questions. And again, I don't do a lot of public speaking, but I appreciate the opportunity. And I'll be honest, I was very excited to see politics in motion here this morning. So thank you very much for the opportunity.
We do what we can.
So I do have one question.
Sure.
In our the draft agreement that was given to us, the deal was that you're going to spend $9 million, and this is showing 16, 15, 16 million.
16 is better than 9.
Yeah, I know. No, I was wondering, is it the difference between the existing building and what the total investment?
That's right. Since the existing building and the site are already here and generating a tax base, we asked them to submit the investment that's going to be a net new
investment
to the county.
I didn't realize it was going to be in an existing facility. That's good.
It's the southern season, though.
That was my question.
It's the former Southern Seasons building in Mebane.
Yeah, that went out of business. Is that correct? Southern Seasons.
They're still in business, but they've reorganized.
Southern Seasons is still in business, but just not using that facility.
And we invested in them, as I recall. I guess we got our investment back.
I can't remember if any county's incentive got paid to Southern Seasons or not. I'm not sure.
We didn't pay it out.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of times, you have business talk to you. There are big corporations. My brother and I mean, my dad started the business. We've been at this thing a long time. We're all in. We live, eat, drink, sleep this business. I mean, we're entrepreneurs, we're growing, and it's a very exciting time for us. So I know that there was you had a bad situation. Everyone has bad situations, but I think we bring a lot to the table.
Will you be able to use local sourcing? I hear you talk a lot about repackaging,
mm-hmm.
and I know we do have some customers in some of the parks around that do plastic Camden, and some of them do different type of plastic manufacturing here in the county.
Most of what we ship would be either in fiber drums or steel drums, but whenever there's an opportunity to source locally, absolutely.
Okay.
I mean, why wouldn't we go local? For instance, we buy a lot of pails. These are plastic pails. If this vendor offers plastic pails, I would definitely want to talk to him, yes. So there are a lot of ancillary things that we haven't even considered yet that are positive. But whenever there's an opportunity to source locally, yes. I will say this. We import our ingredients from all over the world. Unfortunately, America is not all, I'm not making a political statement, but doesn't do the level of manufacturing that they should do, where we're not competitive. But some businesses have left completely. For instance, we sell a lot of vitamin C, ascorbic acid, natural item, everybody's familiar with it. It can't be sourced anywhere but China. And I have different ingredients that are like that. So when there's an opportunity to source locally, absolutely.
Will the rail bring any of your products in? Is that part of this?
This particular property, there is no spur. Honestly, it was too costly.
Is your building, is it going to be any full ownership by your company?
Yes.
No lease.
No lease, Bob.
On your website, and you know, I'm impressed, says that you work with the, you are involved in taking care of the needs of personal care, food, and pharmaceutical industries.
Mm-hmm.
What percentage of what you do is institutional, whether it be like hospitals, or do you do any hospital, or?
No, we are almost exclusively working with manufacturers of products. For instance, hospitals would probably buy certain lotions, creams and lotions. They might buy, there's a fluid that we would sell to the companies that are selling to the hospitals. We would not sell the hospitals directly because we aren't manufacturing. We're just selling the raw materials that go into finished products.
What about pharmaceutical? It mentions pharmaceutical industries. Do you, mm-hmm. Would you be working with the companies at Research Triangle Park, or?
We're very excited about that potential, yes. What this general region does for us, it really opens up a completely new business market for us. Yes, we sell up and down the East Coast, but this geography, we're centrally located. And yes, I mean, there's great potential in the research park and the pharmaceutical business that's done in the area.
My last question is your personnel. 39 jobs. I would think you wouldn't have to go to Raleigh and or Greensboro as long as that is to get 39 people. Are your people, would they be full-time or?
Those jobs would be full-time jobs. It's a little intimidating to drive through this area and see all the companies that are searching for people to come work for them. To me, it reflects that the economy is really good. You have a great deal of employment here. So we're going to have to basically attract. How do we attract? One way is, you know, good wages. So we're going to make it an attractive. I don't know if I'm answering your question.
No, you are. And the last part of that would be, are you hiring yourself or are you going through personnel agencies? Because they supply a lot of temporary labor.
We're not temporary labor. This is full-time labor. We will exhaust all avenues through which to hire people, whether they are private employment search companies, whether there are government outlets through which we can work. We'll access every opportunity that we can. But these are full-time jobs. These are not part-time jobs.
Well, let me say I'm impressed.
Thank you.
Welcome to Alamance County. I have to vote no on incentives. I've done it for almost 2 decades.
I thought we were
going
to get him on one.
It's nothing. it's nothing personal, I'll assure you.
Commissioner, let me just acknowledge, I kind of understand your reservation and I respect it. I would simply say that it's an investment. It's an investment in the region. It's an investment in its people. It's an investment in a new potential business. I think we bring, in all due respect, don't look at it as just an individual transaction, but think about what's coming down the line. So if you vote no, I still respect you. I like you. It's not personal.
Say it again.
We want to work with everyone. And one other thing I'll mention, our customers come in very frequently and they want to audit our facility. And we're going to be an open door for anybody that wants to come in and take a look at what we're doing. We run a good operation, a clean operation, and hopefully you'll be impressed if we do come down here. But we're excited, and of course we want to spend and invest, as you know, in the geography that we're in. So to us, it's just a very exciting opportunity, and we appreciate the questions and the interest.
I have a question. What are some of the skill sets that may be needed for these jobs?
Well, some of the jobs would be warehouse jobs. Okay. The skill set, basically, we would have to educate folks on how to run the various trucks. Some of these things are very high tech. I wouldn't want to get in one of them. Half of the business would be regulatory type jobs, technical documentation, customer service, some sales. I remember when our company was a four-person company, and I look at the operation now, and you know, we're about 35 jobs up north. It's like, wow, we've really grown over time. But I would say it's split between front office and back. I think that it's a skill set that we have to teach in some instances, but we're happy to do that.
Just curious, because our community college is a good resource for employees. When you need technical skills and training, they will work with you.
Yeah, we would. We don't do enough of that right now, and we would take advantage of that.
Great. I had just three little questions. Where are you relocating from?
Somerset, New Jersey.
Okay. And then, I'm sorry, this is a personal question. Are you from Brooklyn originally?
Oh, gosh. Five. I'm not from Brooklyn, but nearby.
Okay. You sound just like my husband's brother-in-law, who's from Brooklyn.
So I hope you like him.
He's awesome.
Okay.
He's a really good guy. And then all the vitamin C comes from China?
Yes.
That is unbelievable.
So we used to have one producer here, a German company, was known as Hoffman LaRoche, and they produced in New Jersey, but no more. So literally on this key raw material, everything comes out of China. Which scares me, because when we're talking about tariffs that are coming up, and they concern me, because I have to tell my customers, well, you're going to have a 10% tariff now and a 25% tariff after January 1. How in the world do they plan for this? I mean, is this going to be long-term, short-term? I don't think it's a good thing when basically America doesn't have any of its own sources. On an item like that, to have to outsource overseas, it's kind of bad.
Mm-hmm. We have as much control over tariffs as we do immigration law. and then the last thing is a little comment that I am so happy that y'all are repurposing a building. I was talking with a citizen recently about how we see, it seems like especially for retail, they just want to plow down trees, pour concrete, put up a new building, instead of reusing the existing buildings that maybe are in decaying neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. And I'm really excited to know that we have a purpose for a building that's not otherwise being used, and that y'all aren't looking to tear down a bunch of trees.
No, really, I mean, nice. Our original business model was, it's called Build to Suit, where we customize a building. We're still customizing a building, but now we're refitting a building. And I agree with you, it makes sense.
That's
I don't
really
want to
nice.
See anything else torn down.
That's really nice. Okay. We should probably have the public, or open and close the public hearing, and then we could have discussion based on what we hear from the public. I think that's appropriate. So
I will make a motion that we go into a public hearing.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to open a public hearing. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right. Is there anyone on this side of the room who wants to be heard on the topic of economic incentives for Universal Preserve at Kim? Yes, sir. Come on forward.
Should I step back?
Yes, please. Okay. If you would have a seat, I think that would be fine. And if you just spell your name for us and tell us who you are, please.
Sure. Good morning. Thanks for having me. My name is Brian Denisar, B-R-I-A-N-D-E-N-I-S-A-R. I'm a resident of Burlington right here in Alamance County. I work for Samet Corporation. We've been working with the folks at UPI and MAC for the last year on this project. We would love to see this come to a close with them and get moving with construction. Like Amy said, this is awesome to take a existing 85,000 square foot building off the market, expand it another 50,000 square feet using local subcontractors, using our team, which is local. So we're in support for UPI and hope you are as well. Tim, if we can sway your vote in any way, we'd love to do that, but we understand that may not be the case.
I think you hit that on the head.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Mr. Denisar. Is there anybody else on this side of the room that needs to be heard on this issue? Seeing none, I'll turn to this side of the room. Is there anyone on this side of the room who wants to be heard on the topic of economic incentive agreements for Universal Preserve account? And nobody is coming forward. Let me ask, do we have anybody in the overflow room? And there's nobody else in the overflow room. So I believe that is all the members of the public who wish to be heard on this topic. If I could have a motion.
Motion to close.
To close.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to close the public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, so now it's time for us to discuss economic incentives for Universal Preserve Kim, and I'll entertain a motion if anyone has one.
Could we just make sure everybody's clear what the incentives are?
Of course.
Be nice.
Certainly. Commissioners, just to review the terms of the proposed incentive agreement with Universal Preserve Kim, UPI is proposing to invest a new taxable investment of up to $9 million. Number of new jobs proposed to be created is 39, with an average wage of $44,192 for these jobs. The incentive that is proposed by Alamance County is a total of $90,000 to be paid over a three-year period, which would be $30,000 per year. The county is projecting, if Universal Preserve Kim hits their maximum capital investment, and the county would pay out its maximum incentive, the cash flow to the county over the three-year incentive period would be $65,760 to the positive. After the three-year incentive period ends, the county would anticipate tax revenues from the project that hopefully would exceed $44,000 a year, and this project does not include temporary workers. So I think that's a summation of the project you have before you.
Well, let me say, I think this is the type of company that Alamance County needs, and I think they're gonna fit right in with the county of Alamance County.
I move we approve the package.
I'd like to ask one question, and this isn't to be negative at all. Great, I agree totally with Bill. But Somerset, is that the county you're in?
It is Somerset Town in Somerset County.
Okay. I'm trying to see what the tax rates are up there. Would you say, though, generically that the taxes here are much lower than what you'd have paid if you'd stayed there?
They're lower.
No doubt about that.
We're glad you're here.
Yes.
We're glad
we're here too.
I'll make a second to that motion.
Okay. And just one little point of clarification, $44,000 a year salary, that is above the current Alamance County average salary, is it not?
Yes, the figure that we are using from the Department of Commerce is $39,152 is the average salary for Alamance County.
And the value of benefits would be on top of that, I'm asking. Maybe Mr. Ravitz could answer. Are benefits on... The value of benefits are on top of the $44,000.
Salary plus benefits.
Yeah, and the $44,000 salary is just salary, not benefits.
Correct. Right.
Outstanding. All right. We Mr. Byrd made a motion to approve the agreement. Mr. Boswell has seconded it. Is there any further discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
No.
Thank you.
I do have a forklift operator's license.
Look out.
Didn't you hear that you don't even have to know how to run the thing?
That, really that's a lot more complicated.
Yeah. Hey, Tim, I just had to pick at you.
That's a lot more complicated than a tow motor.
Yeah.
That is really high tech, what they're getting ready to install down there.
I believe it.
All right, Mr. Haygood, you have something about CECOM for us.
I do.
While you're making the transition, may I just thank Clyde and Andrea in particular for their work to help with all the back and the forth that's going on. It's nice to have that staff support and Brian as well.
Thank you.
Definitely.
As we try to make these things happen, that staff support and that staff response is very critical. I commend them for their work.
Thank you.
Definitely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
I'm going to be presenting some information
about
our 911 Central Communications Department. Do you hear them at work right now?
Is that staged?
Could not have been more appropriate.
That sounds exciting.
Does. This presentation is not going to require any kind of a vote. There's no vote here for you to take. This is simply an update of information to give you a little bit of scoop about CECOM and some issues that we've had recently. I'm sure you're all familiar with the call back in July that involved a tragic incident on Dorset Street in Burlington. And post that call, we've done some review of our protocols and our operations internally, and I'm here this morning to share with you what we've come back with and to let you know that we have taken a good look at this incident and how we react to it. And again, this doesn't require any vote or any action, just to listen. Well, I thought I'd start off with just a little information about Central Communications. This is a county manager department, so this is one that I work with directly. We have on general 34 employees. We do have a lot of turnover in this department. I'll touch on that in just a moment. CECOM receives 911 calls across all of Alamance County. If you're in Alamance County, you place a 911 call from a landline or a cellular phone, you're going to get Alamance County staff in Alamance County CECOM. And the department serves 7 different law enforcement agencies, 12 fire departments, Alamance County Emergency Medical Service, our ambulance service, and Alamance County Rescue. So these are all dispatched from Alamance County 911 communications. The department also monitors alarms for the county. We have alarms in many of our buildings, and CECOM watches those alarms and for the school system as well. And 911 calls that require Burlington Police and Fire Service come to Alamance County CECOM first. They diagnose those calls and then transfer them to the city of Burlington. And that's an issue that we're going to talk about here in just a moment. So before I get into this information about this specific call and our review, you need to understand that CECOM has some challenges. As I'm sure you're aware, our local police and fire departments, our EMS department, have grown over the past several years. They're adding officers, we've added ambulances, they're adding fire staff. CECOM has not grown nearly as much or in proportion with many of the agencies that they serve. I've seen a total number of 911 calls and admin calls increase by about 11% over the time period from 2013 to 2017. Their jobs have also become more difficult. So many folks now are using cell phones. I think roughly 80% of the calls that come into our 911 center are now coming in over cell phone, which means it's not as easy to pinpoint the location as it was when folks were using their landlines, where immediately CECOM knew right where you were calling from. Today, you call, you're not with your cellular phone, it's not always guaranteed that they know exactly where you are when you make that call, so they're having to spend additional time trying to figure that out. However, I will say CECOM has done a good job over the past 4-year period maintaining an average of 98% of the calls that they answer those calls under 10 seconds, and 99% of their calls are answered under 15 seconds. That's well above the national norms, which I believe are about 90%. The national average you shoot for is around 90% of your calls being answered in under 10 seconds. That's very important to the caller, of course. CAD entries, that's our computer automated dispatch, where the computer information that the telecommunicators put in has increased by 52%. They're having to do a lot more entries into the computer. Most of our Law enforcement, fire, and EMS have their own computers in their units now, and they're reading those notes. That's become quite important.
Okay.
And our radio transmission have increased by 31% in this time period, 2013 to 2017. Some other issues that CCOM has faced over the past couple of years, they are, telecommunicators are one of our top nine turnover positions with Alamance County government. At one point in 2017, we had five vacancies, which a shift is seven folks. So that's significant if you have that many vacancies. We currently have three now. That's still an impact on CCOM, but not nearly as drastic as five. This job is complicated. It is multitasking to the extreme. It's one ear full of the 911 caller. The other ear is full of the emergency service provider out on the street. It takes a long time for folks to learn how to do this adequately and to serve the many, many different departments that we have. It's about 6 months to train someone. Currently, our average telecommunicator tenure is 2 years, 7 months. That's not a very long time. The department requested four new telecommunicator positions for this fiscal year. I did not put those positions in my recommended budget. The main reason I did that was because we have multiple vacancies, and my desire was to try to figure out how do we fill our vacancies before we add new positions. So we're going to talk about a position, some position needs that they have based on this call review. So on July 23rd, we received a call in CCOM from an incident that was occurring on Dorset Street. You need to know this was a third-party call. That means someone on a cell phone called this in that was not on the scene. Those are difficult calls for our telecommunicators to figure out what happened. The caller was not at the scene at the time and was relaying information to County 911. The call was processed by our telecommunicator as a psychiatric abnormal behavior call. We'll talk about this a little bit more once we get into recommendations. But that classification required the use of our emergency medical dispatch system, our EMD system. And once we started using EMD to get this call going, to get ambulances rolling, EMD recommended the lowest level of medical response. So it was, and we'll talk a little bit about what that means in a moment, but it was a low-level response call based on EMD protocol. Alamance County EMS was dispatched. No Burlington police were sent at that time. No Burlington fire, which are usually our first responder. The request from CCOM for Burlington police did not come until EMS. EMS staged, called back to CCOM and said, you know, where's Burlington police? Are they en route? At that point, CCOM dispatched Burlington police. So that was not optimum, is to have Burlington police not dispatched until EMS called for it. This did create a delay in law enforcement arrival. This has been well covered in local press that there was a delay in law enforcement arriving to the scene. So after this call, I asked CCOM and to work with EnviroSafe. I wanted to bring in somebody, it was a third party group, to come in and review this call and give us insight from their perspective about how this went and what we could do better. So I thought it would be helpful to bring in a third party that has lots of experience and subject matter experts to help us. The reason why I asked for them to come in was produce an overview of the incident from the emergency communications standpoint. This is not about law enforcement on the scene. This is not about EMS. This is about how this call was handled specifically from an emergency communications perspective. My desire was to develop some recommendations from this outside group to give us some insight about how we can do a better job, what we need to change. Ask this EnviroSafe group to take a look at our protocols, how they may have played a part in how we handled the call, and also how our protocols work with Burlington Communications. That was the one key piece here. It wasn't just Alamance County handling this call. We have involved Burlington Communications, who have their own dispatch service for their police and fire. So EnviroSafe came in and focused primarily on the Dorset Street call. That was where almost all of their attention was paid. We felt like if that call was analyzed closely, we would gain information from that review that would help us in many different ways. EnviroSafe sent in three experts, folks that had extensive experience with Guilford County communications, also with Johnson County communications, and former Burlington Fire Chief came in, met with our staff, multiple interviews with CCOM telecommunicators and CCOM leadership staff, as well as Burlington Communications. They were also involved in this process. Their telecommunicators and their leadership staff were interviewed too to give us feedback. EnviroSafe folks reviewed timelines and protocols. They also looked at 911 industry best practices and research, and they have come up with several recommendations that I'm going to go over with you now. And what you're going to see is we're actually moving on some of these recommendations we've already started working on. EnviroSafe came back with 10 recommendations that were based on the feedback that they got from Alamance and Burlington. And these have been prioritized into two groups, immediate action and intermediate action. I'm going to go over these two groups. And again, as I say, we've begun to act on most of these. So this list, there are seven immediate steps that we need to put in place, and we have begun moving on already. One is to train all 911 personnel in a new protocol that was issued on July 25th, 2018, titled Medical Calls Inside the City of Burlington. So this new protocol was developed by CECOM leadership. It's already been put in place. It directs CECOM staff with specific actions they need to take when medical calls inside the city of Burlington occur. I mentioned here in this slide that we're going to be talking about this policy on October 15th when we meet with a large group of law enforcement agencies, because some of the actions that we will take later will really kind of negate this policy. But this policy is in place right now to help us deal with medical calls inside the city of Burlington until such time as we implement some of these other recommendations. Another recommendation from EnviroSafe is that we implement a law enforcement users group to begin regular dialogue between Alamance County 911 and all law enforcement agencies that are connected to Alamance County 911 in any way. So we already have one meeting scheduled where all law enforcement agencies in Alamance County will come and meet with CECOM staff. That is on Monday, October the 15th. This is going to become a standing group that will meet regularly, monthly, and talk about issues that law enforcement are seeing, issues that Alamance County 911 are seeing, and we'll also have representation from Burlington Communications at these meetings too. We hope this will be a good forum for everyone to talk about what they're seeing as they do their job. Third recommendation that is an immediate point to cover is work with applicable local law enforcement agencies to revise the current trigger points contained in policy entitled Staging of Personnel on Medical Response Service Requests. We have a policy that is devised by our EMS service that dictates when ambulances are staged. Sometimes scenes are too dangerous to send an ambulance to immediately. They need to wait for law enforcement to arrive. So the recommendation from EnviroSafe was you need to review that policy with your law enforcement group. So we will be doing that on October 15th. We're going to start the discussion about staging EMS with law enforcement on the 15th, but then we will be bringing EMS representatives to the table too to talk about, because they are as equally involved in that as law enforcement and CECOM. The fourth recommendation for an immediate action is, in conjunction with the Alamance County Medical Director, review EMD protocol to revise that psychiatric abnormal behavior calls do not often immediately produce alpha-level responses. This is very pertinent to CECOM and to law enforcement. The way we have our emergency medical dispatch protocol set up currently, and that's the EMD is a guide that helps telecommunicators once they start answering a call and they say this is a medical call. It takes them through certain questions that they need to ask. It's very specific. And in this case with the Dorset Street call, once it was determined it was a medical call and it was a psychiatric abnormal behavior call, it started taking the telecommunicator through certain steps. We need to address those protocol steps and make sure that law enforcement and EMS, particularly our medical director, agrees with those protocols. The protocols are set by the medical director. So again, the conversation about revising our EMD protocols will start on October 15th, but EMS, including our medical director, who I believe has already been engaged in this process, will be brought in after the initial conversations with law enforcement. So fifth recommendation for immediate action, implement a system where Burlington Police Communications is advised and acknowledges when EMS is dispatched in the city of Burlington for any purpose, including alpha type emergencies. Alpha type are the lowest level of EMS response. Burlington Police should be aware of all 911 dispatch calls occurring within the city of Burlington, whereas Burlington can decide what calls they respond to or not. At this time, our computers automatically send an alert to Burlington Communications if it's an EMS call that's Bravo, Charlie, Delta, or Echo. Those are the more serious calls. Alpha calls do not. They don't get an automatic. That was a problem in the Dorset Street call. If we could have had it set up to where our alpha calls went to them too. That would have been very helpful. Although we've got the technology in place right now to start sending all those calls to Burlington, we do not. We've talked with Burlington. They want to make sure they understand the volume of those calls. What will that mean to their center? That's a rather low-level call, so that there will be many of them. And, we'll be working with Burlington about how best to implement this change, but we feel like it's important that they know whenever EMS is going into the city of Burlington for a purpose. Did you have a question?
No.
Okay. I'm sorry. So our sixth recommendation, this one's a little more difficult. While the center does have a lead telecommunicator on duty at all times, center does not have a shift supervisor on duty at all times. Consistently designate one person to serve in the capacity of a communications center supervisor at all times. If the designated person is not in place for some reason, the chain of command would designate another person for that responsibility. There should be a clear person of authority and responsibility. So at this time, we have lead telecommunicators on all four shifts. The lead telecommunicators are not supervisors of the other telecommunicators. They're kind of like the most experienced ones that can help the other telecommunicators, but they're not in a position of clear authority over the other telecommunicators. We've had supervisors for the past 2 years on both night shifts. We've recently moved one night shift supervisor into a quality assurance role. That has been very helpful, but it does mean that there's not a, at this time, a night shift supervisor in position for the night. And the day shifts have only had lead telecommunicators. So that was a point that was noted during this Dorset Street call, that if we, and one of the problems we have with our current supervisors and lead telecommunicators is that they also work a console. So they're not only trying to help the other telecommunicators, they have their own phone that they're answering and groups of services that they're dispatching. What we're talking about here with this recommendation is adding positions in CCOM that will not sit at a console, that are over the floor, that are listening to everybody and stepping in whenever they are needed. That would be a great thing to add to CCOM. We've run the numbers for costs to do that for the rest of this fiscal year beginning in December. We need to find an additional $88,000, which we are looking for at this time. The total cost for three new shift supervisor positions would be approximately $176,000. This is very important. This would add an element to CCOM where somebody that's not actively engaged in an incident can be on the floor live overviewing it, but it is a funding issue. As I say, we're on the prowl right now for the $88,000. If we can find it, I'll be coming back before you and asking you to implement new positions, and I'll tell you where the money is coming from. But at this time, we do not have it identified. And the final immediate recommendation that came from this call review is to strengthen accountability, implement a tracking system that can report when any public safety agency is requested to respond to an incident and response is refused or the agency is incapable of responding so that the data can be tracked. The current CAD system should be easily capable of managing this tracking, with a new code recognizing any time that there is a failure to respond by any agency for any reason. So we have at times where agencies cannot respond. They may be stretched thin, they may not be able to get volunteers to the station, lots of reasons. And our trigger point policy is another reason. There are times when we may call for law enforcement to respond, but the trigger points have not been met. Law enforcement is not going to respond if those specific agreed upon trigger points are not met. We don't track that at this time, and that's not optimum for us. We should be tracking these. We have put the technology in place. It is in place right now. These are being tracked currently, and my plan is to have monthly reports provided to county management as well as the groups that we serve, because I think their chiefs and their leadership need to know how often is it a regular occurrence that they're not able to muster folks to meet a call, or if we're calling for assistance that doesn't meet agreed upon policy, we need to be able to track that and have a discussion with that agency and say, this happened 5 times last month. Is it a specific telecommunicator? Is it a paramedic? Is it law enforcement? Why is this happening? So I think this will be very helpful as we go forward. But we have implemented this and are tracking it now. Then we had three intermediate recommendations for actions to take after this review. These are longer term, a little bit longer term. Implement emergency police dispatch as soon as conditions will allow. I'll tell you that the CCOM was working on putting EPD, which is very much like EMD, it's card-driven, step-driven directions for telecommunicators. They were preparing to implement that before the Dorset Street call, but I think two things came into play. One was our high vacancy number, and two was difficult to get folks to come and train. We currently have training set up to get CECOM ready to implement EPD the first week of December, and the EnviroSafe people told us that this was one of the key pieces from the Dorset Street call. If we had EPD in place, this could have helped us get law enforcement to the scene quicker than we did. Full implementation of EPD is planned to begin the first week of January. So we have the software, we have the system, training starts in December. We hope to have it fully implemented by January. Until that time, we will continue to work with trigger point policies and with our policy that CECOM came up with in July. The second intermediate recommendation was as a part of that implementation, the EPD implementation. Visit other North Carolina 911 centers using the EPD protocol, such as Johnston County, to gain a high level of familiarity before implementation. Some other nearby public safety answering points using EPD include Durham, Davidson, Rockingham, and Stokes. So in the interim, since the Dorset Street call, we've sent five telecommunicators from CECOM. They went to Durham County on September 19th. We're able to observe the EPD system in use. They were also able to listen in to how calls were handled. As we get closer to the implementation date, we'll send more CECOM staff to Durham and to some of these other locations to get firsthand a taste of how EPD works. And the final intermediate recommendation is one that I think will take some work, but I do believe is important for us to pursue. So to enhance overall service delivery, explore the viability of a consolidated emergency communication center between Alamance County and the City of Burlington. If not a fully consolidated center, consider a functional consolidation whereas all telecommunicators work out of the same physical location. Successful examples of each model are available throughout North Carolina. So what we're talking about with this recommendation, and this is one that the City of Burlington and the county have known as something to work for, but I think this call and this review has brought it to the forefront, is to have, at the very least, a co-located 911 center where Alamance County CECOM telecommunicators and Burlington CECOM telecommunicators are at least in the same space together. That could have helped us with this particular call. If we're in the same space and you can hear each other and you can observe what's going on as opposed to having the two centers separate, across town, having to transfer calls and depending on the computer to determine when information gets forwarded to Burlington. I think this is a worthy goal to pursue. I do think co-location is probably more likely to be the way to start this. So we'll be talking about this with the City of Burlington. And we have to also talk about it with our other service providers, the other law enforcement agencies and fire departments that we serve. So, overall, I would say the review gave us some things to address that we've started to address, our EMD protocols, our policy on psychiatric calls, how we communicate with the City of Burlington. The main point of this presentation is to let you and the public know we've took a hard look at what happened at the Dorset Street call. We've identified things to work on, and we've started that process now. So I would certainly be happy to try to answer any questions about what you've seen today. I've provided you with a handout, too, so you can take a look at it at your leisure.
What would be our next step to have a Burlington-Alamance County center together? What do we need to do as commissioners to pursue that?
Well, I think one thing that has happened directly from this review is this this established meeting of law enforcement agencies and CECOM regularly. This will be a topic that will be discussed. Another thing that the board has done already is we've begun our facility planning process, and this is a piece that has come to the forefront, is the possibility of relocating CECOM from this building and thinking about how do you do that in conjunction with emergency management, fire marshal, EOC, and we know that there is good sense in at least co-location of Burlington. So I think what we will do is start talking with the City of Burlington about how from a facility standpoint might that work. Where would they go? Where could they get together? Because that's part of it. The other part is the protocol piece. You know, how do you align your policies where you can work together? But I think having us, and I've told you that the facility plan will be done by the end of this calendar year. So I think you'll be seeing me in December with a larger scale plan that will include how we might address facility-wise a co-located communication system.
I saw your $88,000 for these positions. One lawsuit costs how much? Well,
a lot more than that.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, that's a priority to figure out how to do. I think that would make a big difference in CECOM. So, yes, sir.
So if we get a call, and it obviously the Burlington Police needs to be called. We call their 911, their call center, and they dispatch the Burlington Police.
Yes, and sometimes they can also see our computers. So at certain points, the connection is made automatically. So for example, those EMS calls, if it's a Bravo through Echo, it's automatic. So if we're sending an ambulance to the city of Burlington and it's been classified as a more severe call, we don't even have to call the telecommunicators in Burlington. It starts populating their fields. It starts letting them know automatically. So it's done. It's done through a connection, computer to computer, and also by phone.
So why are there two call centers?
I think that's been tradition, perhaps. Also, Burlington has had maybe a willingness to invest in their groups that's been outpaced us at times, just to be candid. We're reaching a point, though, where we're going to have to make investments in CECOM. We're seeing that. I think that's part of this call review, is our turnover contributed to this, having relatively inexperienced folks down there, which is no fault of theirs. They just don't have the time and the seat that they need. So CECOM's going to become one of our priority issues and operating budgets for the future.
Did Burlington pay for any of the cost on this survey?
No.
How much was total cost?
It's $4,900.
Okay. Let me take you back a few years, and Bob answered your question to a degree. And I want to know, when I give you this scenario, what the difference is today and the same situation existed. Back, 20 years ago, probably, close to it, Burlington wanted to have 911 calls that were made in the city limits go to Burlington. And they came down here, the city council, the mayor, and everything. And there was a lot of debate about it. And the net result of the investigation of that was that the 911 calls would not only be for police, but also for the ambulance. And if the 911 call then came in from the city limits of Burlington, and it had something to do with the phone company as well, as far as how those calls were to be channeled. But if somebody in Burlington needs an ambulance, and the call went to Burlington because they were in the city limits, then Burlington was going to have to kick it back to the county.
Yes.
Because the county was going to dispatch. And so I asked the question. It was funny, really. And it got, there was a heck of a debate. Benny Brooks?
Yes.
Was over EMS. And when I asked the question, it was said to me that Benny Brooks told me to ask that question. I mean, that I couldn't be smart enough to have figured it out. They really got me. And the long story short was, I asked the chief of police when he was in here, how many police calls do you get from 911 that are code 3s, code 2s, and code 1s? He couldn't answer the question. And I would say the vast majority were code 1s or 2s. 3 was the emergency, right?
I'm not sure. I don't know.
Do they still do it that way?
I don't know. I don't know.
They still do it that way.
You send them emergency or non-emergency basis.
Right. So I sat back and I said, well, look, it appears to me that I would, you know, all the ambulance calls to me are code, what's the worst code, 3?
Or ambulance calls?
Yeah.
It's Echo now, but once upon a time it was code 3.
Okay, well, that's why I am trying to say that's what it was then, and let's try to mesh it together and see what the difference would be. Now, and so I said, you know, all the calls, in my opinion, for an ambulance would be code 3s, you know, emergency. But only a fraction of your calls for the police department are code 3s. And the chief of police said, you don't even know what the codes are. It got nasty. And I said, yeah, code 1 is when you get time. How about riding over here? Code 2s, put down your whatever. I won't go into it. It really got to be a clash.
I remember that too, Tim.
You remember that?
Yes, I do.
And I said, you know, I'd rather kick it back to you, the police calls, than send any of our ambulance calls to you, and you have to kick it back to us. Which kicking back is more important or less, whatever, you know what I'm trying to say. Now, the net result, talking about a call center, was $7 million to build a call center for everything to be together. That was 20 years ago.
Sure.
So I don't know what it would cost today. But
Well, I would say that the state looks favorably on any time you can consolidate centers because you know, they see value in having the same place that the 911 call comes to originally where all the dispatch service is coming from. I think Rockingham County recently received a significant amount of money from the state to build a new facility because that was the ultimate goal. I think if we're doing our facility plan, if we identify that as a need, I can assure you that we would be trying to exhaust every possible way to bring funding in from the state who also has that interest at heart. And there really is, in my humble opinion, value in having at the minimum co-location. I think you're able to have groups that are mutual aid groups in the same room. So it may be a Burlington police call, but it might be Hall River or Graham coming on a mutual aid. And if all that is in one place together, that is.
Well, I would say to you, 20 years ago, you wouldn't have concluded it. And that's what I'm asking. 20 years ago, in my opinion, you wouldn't have concluded that.
Technology. What's moved, though.
What's the difference now as far as makes it more up your alley to support it versus supporting it 20 years ago? Of course, you didn't really have that answer, but we would have never gone with the cost and the practicality of losing all the 911 calls for ambulance.
Sure.
We wouldn't have, in the city of Burlington, we wouldn't have yielded that knowing it had to come back to us. And I guess you're saying it wouldn't have all that coming back possibly.
Well,
right?
And I don't want to come across to the board that I'm suggesting that the county give up its role as PSAP or dispatch of services. That I think what we should target at this point is we keep our role. We get the 911 calls. We dispatch the agencies that we dispatch. Burlington dispatches the agencies that they dispatch, which is Burlington Fire and Burlington Police, but they are in the same room together. So it's not an all or nothing. We have to do it all. They have to give up their ability to create policies that benefit their services. I don't think that's necessary, at least to start the discussion. And I will say Burlington has been very supportive of this process, this call review process. I think they appreciated the fact that we thought this was serious enough to bring somebody in outside with expertise in the field to look at us with an objective eye. And because they're dependent on us, the city of Burlington is depending on us to answer those calls and accurately diagnose them and get them over to Burlington. So I would certainly not want to say that I'm suggesting to the board that we give up our role or that we consolidate everybody in one pile for who's in charge, nothing like that. I think you can do it and have co-location, telecommunicators in the same space, still city, still county, doing their thing, but there is benefit, in my opinion, for them being together in that same area.
How's that affect Mabin and Graham and Elon?
They're all being dispatched now by the county. I think Elon University, Hall River, Graham, Mabin, Sheriff's Department, those law enforcement agencies are all being dispatched by county government now. I would see that it would be a benefit for them if we were in the same room with Burlington, because again, their mutual aid, oftentimes Burlington Police is mutual aid to Hall River. If a Hall River policeman's in trouble and needs help, they butt up, so it might be a Burlington Police coming. If you're all in the same room, at least the Burlington telecommunicators are getting real-time information about what's happening with that Hall River policeman, as opposed to we're trying to create a patch, we're trying to talk over to Burlington and tell them there's a chase, it's multi-jurisdictional. Now, if you're in the same space, you know that's going on. You don't have to wait. And again, it's not even that you're county is your dispatcher. It's just you're together.
Have you been to any of the four counties that have done this already? Durham, Davidson, Rockingham, Stoke?
CCOM sent, I think it was five folks to Durham back in September, middle of September, to observe EPD and see how it works. Now, they were going to look at this specific software product. We already own it, but we just haven't implemented it yet. So they've been to visit that. And then our ViruSafe also provided us with a list of all PSAPs across the state and how they're set up. Are they city? Are they county? Are they consolidated? I can't remember off the top of my head if any were co-located, but if they are, we would want to go see them as a part of this process.
Let me say, if the commissioners want a lesson in life, go down and sit with SECOM for 2 hours. You would not believe what goes on down there. It is unbelievable.
It is.
It's better than going to a movie.
It is. It's a highly specialized skill.
It really is.
I had a couple of questions. Could you say something about the complexity of Alamance County's communications handling multiple jurisdictions with different protocols versus Burlington doesn't have that issue. They have one municipality and they have their own protocols that they know. So our telecommunicators have a complexity that Burlington doesn't have to, or a challenge that they don't have to face. Is that right?
I would tend to agree. I'm not intimately familiar with Burlington's protocols, but the fact that Burlington Telecommunications is dispatching Burlington Fire and Burlington Police, where you have the county dispatching 7 different law enforcement agencies and 12 different fire departments, those are, and each one of them have their own protocol or their own way of talking, you know, that our telecommunicators are having to learn and be familiar with. That is not to take anything away from how tough it is to be a Burlington communicator, but absolutely not. It is a different environment, I think, in this communication center here with the county. Yes.
And I think that the emergency services from around the county are interested in this issue and the communications aspect of it from my conversations. And could you say something more about the 911 money that might be available from the state and the challenges of getting that? And I think that would be something that's different from 20 years ago, if that money is available from the 911 agency.
Yes, it's the 911 board, and it's taxes paid via cell phones. Is that correct,
Dexter? Yes, the fee that you pay for 911 is on your bill. I think it's like 60 cents per line. And whether you have a cell phone or a wireline phone, either way, you're paying that.
So this generates a significant amount of revenue across the state of North Carolina, and we get a share of it here in Alamance County. It is very difficult to spend that money. The state has put many restrictions on what you can do with the money, and so we have struggled with using it for different reasons. We've been able to buy equipment. We're not able to pay salaries. We've talked about, can we use it to do recruiting, advertising drives? Can we try to get the word out? It's very, very limited use. But that would be the money from the state level that we would be talking with the state about. If we go the route of building a center, that's where we're trying to co-locate folks, that's the pot of money that we would try to get them to tap. If I'm not mistaken, I think that was those were funds they used in Rockingham to construct that facility. And I think that's a pretty recent facility construction in Rockingham County within the past couple of years.
What did it cost, Brian?
For some reason, $6-7 million sticks in my head, but I would be hesitant to quote that as a definite. Uh-huh. But it's a multi-million.
You could use the same consoles, so you wouldn't have to buy all new equipment.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes. And I think what we have seen so far through our facility plan process is there would be value in having perhaps co-located Burlington and County Communications, as well as an EOC capable of handling. We had our debriefing recently about our EOC. If we had a very large-scale event in Alamance County, we would struggle with our current EOC. But all that makes sense to put in one place: an emergency operations center, a communications center, and then departments that have connection to emergency operations, perhaps being in the same place, be very valuable.
Yeah,
you
know, emergency EOC means emergency operations center,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So it's been pointed out by people in this community that if you take the entire population of our county, it's still just a small city.
Yes.
So it seems like there should be lots of opportunity to consolidate.
Yes, I think so. And again, let me just say that Burlington's been with us through this review process. They were part of the process. They opened their doors and allowed the reviewers to come in and meet with their telecommunicators and their leadership. They've been very supportive and very open to these discussions. I certainly appreciate that, and I think that's in the best interest of the citizens, too. So they're to be commended.
I think Randolph just built a big center down there. If you could check into that, I'd appreciate it. Now, part of the issue, too, is, you know, Burlington, if you call for an ambulance in Burlington, a fire truck comes out. And not only the ambulance shows up, the fire truck shows up. And a lot of times, fire truck gets there first because they got, you know, their station nearby. But they don't, in all honesty, they probably just, I would think, wait more for the EMS to show up if they're close.
But their fire trucks do have EMTs.
Right, I realize that. But how does the fire truck get notified? In other words, from Graham here, you get a 911 call for an ambulance in the city of Burlington, and then who from here, Burlington dispatches the fire truck or what?
We will dispatch them on the initial dispatch. So we'll
Graham don't send fire trucks.
Graham doesn't send them?
No.
Really?
Graham or Burlington?
Alamance County.
Well, I'll talk about Burlington.
Okay. With Burlington, we'll dispatch them on the initial dispatch.
Right.
Once they determine whether it's going to be a Bravo, Charlie, Delta, Echo call, our CAD, we'll talk to their CAD, if you will, their link. And when it sees a certain determinant, it will go ahead and send a call over to them, and you'll see it come up in their CAD in their computers. And at that time, they can make the dispatch as well. They'll go ahead and dispatch their fire department. And if it warrants sending police, they see something in the notes that would say that police need to go, then they'll go ahead.
Does Mebane or Hall River or Elon do the same, or do they not, or they, you say Graham doesn't send them out?
Graham's the only one that don't.
All right. So everybody else does, right?
They do dispatch them on accidents with injuries, though. They do send up the fire department out on those. As far as the others go, we dispatch for them, so we automatically tell them when EMS is coming into their city or town.
Right. It was $8 million. It was 911 funds.
In Rockingham County.
Okay. How much?
$8 million.
$8 million.
That's all I have, Madam Chair. So.
Thank you. Thank you so much. All right. The next item on our agenda is all the items on our agenda are very important. The next item on our agenda is extremely important, and I want to be sure that. It gets its full attention. So in advance of that, would y'all like to take a recess?
Yes.
It's been almost 2 hours. All right. So we can pay attention better. Thank you. All right, we're recessed. Ladies and gentlemen, if we could come to order, please, and resume our work today. Next on our agenda is a nonprofit facility opportunity. We'll hear from Mr. Haygood and Director Osborne.
Thank you, Commissioners. I'm here before you this morning to give you some information about a wonderful opportunity that Alamance County has to provide some high-quality space for several nonprofit groups here in Alamance County. We have with us today Mr. Ron Petrie, who is a resident of Alamance County, and he's expressed a desire to partner with us to create a new space for three nonprofits and for DSS to make use of. Susan Osborne and I, come on up, Susan, please. Susan and I have had the pleasure of working with Mr. Petrie for several years as he's evaluated what he thinks is best and what he wants to do. We're very excited to have him with us today, and he has indicated that he would be interested in investing up to $2.5 million in a new county-owned facility that would be available for Friendship Adult Day Services, which is currently located in the Elderly Service Building, and the Open Door Clinic, which is located right behind the Human Service Center in the old Out Clinic space. We have Tracy Salisbury, who is the executive director of the Open Door Clinic, with us here today. The new space that Mr. Petrie is talking with us about putting together would also be used for family abuse services and for DSS for visitation times for children and their families. So it would have lots of use and be a very popular and welcome addition. The location of the new facility is, you'll see it up here on the screen, and I have a copy of it for you too. So the location that we've worked with Mr. Petrie to select is behind the Human Service Center, right off of Rudd Street. It's a little difficult to see, I'm sorry, on this map, perhaps the way it's scaled, but the pointer gets eaten up by the TV screen if I use the laser pointer, but it's right here. So here you have Rudd Street, here you have Rudd Street EMS base, large cleared lot right here at the back of the parking lot for the Human Service Center.
Yes.
That's the location we've worked with Mr. Petrie to find. It's a fine location. We're all very excited about it. It's right in the heart of lots of other county services, lots of other nonprofit services as well. So it also fits in with what we're seeing so far in our facility plan, and that's good news. The facility would provide a long-term home for Friendship Adult Day Service and Open Door Clinic. Mr. Petrie's funds would be used to plan the facility for plan, design, and construction. At the end of the project, it would become a county building that the county would manage. So, Susan, want to tell us a little bit about the nonprofits that we're working with Mr. Petrie with?
Sure, I'm glad to. So, as you can imagine, we're very excited about this possibility that it offers the citizens of our community. And there are several reasons. The nonprofit's going into what I'll call the Petrie Center, but Mr. Petrie will not want that to be. but for our purposes this morning, I'll just call it the Petrie Center. So there are a couple of really big positives for these nonprofits. One is that the space will be designed to meet their needs. So we're talking about Friendship Center, we're talking about Open Door Clinic, and we're talking about supervised visitation. So that really allows for some efficiencies of space. All those agencies are currently in buildings that were something else. Open Door Clinic is in the old MRI building, not conducive to their work. Friendship Center is in the old mental health building, and so some real efficiencies. The other opportunity for these groups is really expansion, and I want to talk just a minute about what that means for our citizens of our community. So for the Open Door Clinic to look at more efficient space and more space, this really translates into more health care. Tracy's already received some grants to expand services for our uninsured and underinsured, and so that's what it means. For Friendship Center, we're talking about better space, but also more space. And so Mr. Petrie's vision is that Friendship Center would expand. They currently have a waiting list and be able to serve more folks. Friendship Center's purpose is for elderly folks to come during the day so that they can remain in their home and not have to be in institutional care for as long as possible, and so that's what they do. And then for family abuse services and social services for supervised visitation, that really translates directly into services to children. And it's really about keeping them safe as they visit with their parents who are involved in domestic violence situations or in reunification efforts. With this building, in addition to those three that will benefit directly, another benefactor is created by Mr. Petrie's legacy, and that is our diversion center. Because we can't move towards renovating the elderly services building until Friendship Center has a new home. So, and the diversion center, as you know, is a vision for our community through our efforts with our sheriff and our chair of our Stepping Up initiative, Commissioner Byrd. So I just want to add that county government is truly at its best when we are defined by positive outcomes for those that we're here to serve. Both Mr. Petrie's vision and his gift give us this opportunity to further define our caring and our service to our citizens. So it's my honor this morning to introduce to you Mr. Ron Petrie, for you to have the opportunity to meet this amazing, humble, purposeful man, benefactor, discuss any thoughts you have about his project and answer any questions that you have. And consider this opportunity before you. Mr. Petrie has done this project in Stokes County and built a community center and a primary health care clinic that they didn't have. That's where he was born, but he lived most of his life here in Alamance County. And as Brian said, we've been working with Mr. Petrie for a while, and he wants to leave a legacy here in Alamance County. So I introduce Mr. Ron Petrie.
Thank you.
I told Brian that I'd be willing to step up and answer any questions that you might have, but before you do that, I'll say a few things that make it so there'd be less questions that would probably come up anyway. I'm a native of Graham, went to Graham High School, and I'm in my mid to latter 70s, my age, and I'm retired, living for the last 35 years in the Hallfields community, down below the Hallfields Presbyterian Church on 119. And I might say that what funding I have and my sister now, this money really is coming from my sister's estate. I and my sister both have revocable living trust. She passed away in January this year after 6-7 years or more of dementia. She taught most of her life in Florida. And I went down there in 2010, got her up here, because I could see her husband died in 2006, just a year after my sister and my mother passed away here. And so my sister wasn't making all that much money teaching, and most of my funding and a good part of hers, not as much as the percentage of mine, definitely didn't come from inheritance. Because when my father passed away at an early age, he always wanted to be a millionaire, but he never got much over, I don't think, $100,000. So he gave, most of that went to my mother. And some of his stocks, most of his wealth that he had was in stocks, Merrill Lynch. Some went to my sister. I didn't get asked for anything. I'd have got the business that I was helping him with, office furniture retail, and a little small rental home. And that was the extent. So I have to say that most of what I've earned, most of what I am worth now, or have been, a lot of it's gone now, here lately, but came from investments more than from hard labor. Because I retired I taught school for a few years, and then went into the business. And then, after school, teaching, I went in service for 3 years during the Vietnam crisis. And then came out and went in with my dad, who was switching over at that time from retail household furniture sales to office furniture. And he didn't have any help, and so that ended up being the end of my teaching. I was planning to go back into that until I saw his situation. So in my sister's case, she held on to what few stocks my dad gave her, and she invested more in bonds and stocks and whatnot. And I did also, and we were, you might just say, we were lucky, fortunate in how it turned out. But actually, the donation is coming from my sister's estate. In her revocable living trust, I have the authority as her trustee to make gifts from her estate to nonprofit charities. And that's what I'm planning to do. And it really, instead of $2.5 million, it's $3 million. $2.5 million is set up for this facility that Brian mentioned. But if it runs over that, then there would be that much less that I'm going to contribute of that $3 million for the renovation or reconstruction, whatever you want to call it, of the mental health building that Friendship is going to be moving out of. So we don't know how that's going to go, but Brian knows that $3 million is going to be the limit. That's about all she has in her firm. Very little over that, and by the time where I have to dish the money out to the county, stocks might be down, one thing or another. You don't know whether all that funds. But right now, in her account, brokerage account is a little over $3 million. And mine's much smaller because Brian and Susan have been to the facility that I constructed where my parents were born and raised in Stokes County, right above Passaic County. And then you're in Virginia above that. It's a poorer county, has a lower tax base than Alamance by far. And I used to go up there as a little child. My parents would send me up there after they moved here in this area. and I would help my uncle, who stayed on with my mother and her three siblings. He was the only one that remained after they all grew up. He farmed, raised tobacco, and I attended the church right across the highway, Presbyterian Church, that my great-grandfather gave the land for and helped build it. And it's now about 160 years old. It's still small, and I don't know how much longer it's going to have members, because as with a lot of churches, they're dwindling in membership and closing. So anyway, and I just wanted to help the people up there. My uncle made sure that everywhere I went with him, that I got to meet the people. And he had the habit of saying, this is Sarah's boy. That was my mother, his sister. He's exactly 42 years older than him. He liked to switch it around. We both had the same birthday, June the 12th. So he would switch it around and say I was older, and I can't ever forget that. Everybody would laugh when they'd hear it. But in church, I knew everybody that went to that church. He made it a point that I did. And to be all truthful with you, I feel closer, even though I live down here, never lived up there as a resident. But I would continue to go up there and visit my grandmother that stayed on her. She would have been 98 years old if she'd have lived just a couple more months. She was born in 1872, and so I knew her well, and so forth. So I feel closer to that area because of that young age of going up there, more so than all the years that I've lived down here. So I felt like that I owe those people something, that anybody that's still left in the family, I owe them. Why? Because I feel like that my uncle relied on a lot of those people to come in and help put up a barn of tobacco over the years. He would go down to, this was in Pine Hall in Stokes County. The only thing in Pine Hall, they got a big copper plant right across the highway on 311. It's not obstructed to see because it's way on back, kind of in the woods, but it's something you would find more likely in the city of Charlotte. It's huge. And a lot of people there in the county work there. In fact, the county manager told me that they're even using the conference room for their big meetings there, which is across the highway, instead of there in their own building. I said, well, gosh, don't they have a large one? And he said, yeah, they probably do, but they don't probably have a kitchen and one thing or another, you know, right at it, like they do up there. So that's why I did that. And Susan and Brian both had been up there in some kind of regional meetings once or maybe twice, I don't know. And they were shown the facility right after it opened. The medical part hadn't opened. But anyway, it's a community building for the people there in the county, or in that area, Pine Hall and surrounding area. Wanted them to be able to have their anniversaries and other meetings there and so forth. And I think that's good. Now, here, the two facilities that I would like to see, anyway, one, I didn't know about the second one. I told Brian he could pick out where there was really a needy group that needed to come in to that building. And he picked out the open door clinic. And now, from talking with Tracy, I'm more satisfied with something like that coming in as opposed to just the clinic part of this L-shaped building up there in Stokes County. Why? Because here, they're treating people, your volunteer doctors and nurses and so forth, people that are indigent, that don't have the money to pay and they can't get Medicare or Medicaid, either one. But up there, the hospital, the county hospital in Stokes County, the county government owns the hospital building. They're leasing out the facility to an out-of-state firm. They're going to be operating. It's a doctor in there now, an MD, one or two nurses, one or two receptions as you go in. It's a big part of it. But the whole thing's only about 7,500 square feet, where this facility that Brian was talking about is going to be probably around 10,500 or something like that, maybe a little bit bigger. If it falls under the $2.5 million, the architect was down here this past Wednesday and spoke with each one of the people for one afternoon and got the details as to how they want it set up. the rooms, so forth, and why they need it, and so he took all that down, and he'll go from there. But if it falls under the $2.5 million, ask the architect if he can perhaps make two of the functions of the Open Door Clinic and Friendship maybe a little larger where they need it. Like the Friendship, they need a probably even a larger building, a larger area set aside where they have most of the people that they can see at one time. And the whole thing is going to be bigger because right now they're set up to where they cannot see more than for 36 patients. 36 is the limit. But we're increasing the size. You've got to have more restrooms. And the architect has got to call the person down there at Raleigh over the human services to get all the details as to the codes that they have to follow and what it's going to take for it to be 48. Go from 36 to be able later on to have as many as 48. And I feel like this is important because you put $2.5 million in a building, you want more than just a few people to be served. And as it is now, they have a waiting list because a lot of the ones they serve, the ones with mental handicaps, that some, I like that idea too, very much, mental handicaps, because during my life, I've always thought, gosh, if I got married and had children, which I regret, I never did, that's been one of my big mistakes. Because if I had, I'd probably been about as broke as any of you folks could.
Thank you for recognizing that.
So I didn't have that problem, but I've got more of a problem now that I want to see that what my sister and I have go to good use. Not just one person, but a group, a lot of people that can benefit from this. And so let's see if there's anything else. So the architect will, the main big room in the Friendship would be where they can see more people, want everybody at one time, maybe at given times, where they can keep up with them. As it is now, they're in an L shape for a two-part where they have to turn their head to see who all is in the other part. And then they got other rooms for different purposes too. And then in the case of Tracy, she went along with the fact that it's going to be a different kind of arrangements for her. It's kind of like at ER at the hospital. You've got these little waiting rooms for the patients to come in, maybe going around in a square or maybe a circle, and then all what takes place is in the middle, like at ER. And I was told maybe it'd be a good idea to maybe make that part a little bit bigger other than the other rooms that are needed. But that's the main room, is that right? That's needed there. So that's the plan. And then if there's anything, if it costs under the $2.5 million to make the thing bigger to where maybe it does come up to $2.5 million, then there'll be $500,000 left to help what the county has already, $1.2 million or something, to renovate the old mental health building that I'm familiar with also. Because my sister, I took her over there to the Friendship, but it's to give me a little break every now and then, because I was the only caregiver. And when I'm the only one left, I've got cousins that live, I don't know where all, but most of them out of state, not calling on any of them to help out or be around. So I'm the end of a family, and that's a shame. I regret that. My sister was married twice, but had no children. I guess she was unable to, and then I failed to get married, so it's a bad thing when your family ends, I think. So that's about all I have to say. If it runs over $2.5 million, the facility we're talking about, there would be less left than $3 million that will go to the renovation for the other building.
Where's your church at in Stokes County? The church you mentioned?
It's Pine Hall Presbyterian Church.
Where's that located?
On 311 between Madison, which is in Rockingham County, and the nearest town in Stokes County would be Walnut Cove. Mm-hmm. 311 goes somewhere up around Virginia, goes on down to Winston-Salem, and then to High Point. Now, I don't know how much further.
You used to have a pretty good racetrack up there, too.
It's closed, thank goodness.
Is it gone for good?
Yeah, well, I hadn't been up there too often. During the time that this building was put up, this community building and medical clinic, I was attending my sister, and they had to come down here. The county manager and the architect came down to my home, just like Brian and
Susan.
Yeah, Susan. I'm having trouble at my age, and I think I'm getting dementia too, remembering things. And it, the word didn't come out, and then maybe I'll be talking about something else, and it moves from one part of my brain to where it comes out then. So I don't know what's happening.
Happened to me every day.
Yeah. So, see, I've already forgot what I was talking about. But anyway.
About the racetrack.
The racetrack, thank you. Yeah. So I went up there the spring of last year for the ribbon cut. And that's the first I'd seen. They had sent me pictures, you know, all along when it was being built, what was happening and whatnot, but I didn't have a chance to go. And I was told that the racetrack closed a year or two before that, and I said, well, I hope it doesn't reopen, because even though it's maybe Friday or Saturday night, oh, you can hear it.
Oh,
and
yes.
It's something that when I was, and it's been there a long time. When I was small, I never did like it. A lot of the people around there said they got kind of used to it, but I wasn't there that long enough to ever get used to it. So I'm hoping it doesn't reopen for the, you know, for just the purpose of it being so close,
yeah.
Only about a mile in Rockingham County is where the county line is. So we'll see about that.
Well, I'm going to visit your church, if you don't mind, when I get up that way.
It's a small
church. Yeah, Tim's from up there.
No, I'm
not.
What? Well, that's where you live.
He just goes.
Do what?
Did you live up there a while?
No. Well, I lived in Rockingham County.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but I go through Stokesdale a lot.
Yeah.
Walnut Cove and area.
One of the doctors, physicians, MD, a lady, she, for some reason, she found out about this building going up and needing people, you know, to come in, nurses and whatnot. She left there and is the doctor, MD there, and brought all her patients. All her patients coming up. So that's a good start, you know, for the area, Pine Hall, which would be slow in starting. Everybody's got their own doctor somewhere, and supposedly. But and then another doctor passed away in Rockingham County, I believe, and his patients are coming there. So they're off with a big start. You might have to enlarge that thing. I don't know.
I think this is not your first donation to Alamance County.
Oh, no.
I don't think. I think the community college.
Brian worked with me.
Got a nice donation from you.
About making a donation to the community college.
Yes.
We went several different times to one track that didn't work out, and then to another track that Bill Covington and his wife owned, 47 acres. And we had a meeting of, Brian was there, and the people at the college, the president and a bunch of them, the agriculture department. And it ended up that I made a pretty big donation for them to buy that.
We talk about that occasionally on the building and ground at the community college, and I knew your name from that. So.
The horticulture department, I think, is real strong there.
They're moving,
And they needed the land to get out of that lowland that's prone to flood. Land.
Thank you for that.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so that was done also. Forgot about that. So are there any other questions?
This building, it looks like it's about where the old helipad used to be for County Hospital. Would the entrance be off of Red Street or through the parking lot behind it?
Probably Red Street.
We've talked about maybe a main entrance from Red Street, but a connection to the parking area and to the HSC building. But the main advertised entrance and street address.
How much additional parking are we talking about there to be needed? Have you looked into that?
We have looked at that site for how many spaces it were, would hold with a building of this size. I think it was going to hold between 30 and 40 new spaces, plus the building between 10 and 11,000 square feet.
Possible 30 new spots.
Yes. Yes.
The Friendship Daycare, Connie over there mentioned that they don't need that many spaces. So many of them come in on this transportation park and then leave that. And then the other, you operate just in the evenings, don't you, mostly?
We have daytime clinics as well.
Well, how many spaces probably you anticipate needing?
I would say with staff, which we're already using, the county
parking spaces, so I won't count that, but I would say 10 to 15.
So it's not going to be all that.
So that whole block is basically the county's property.
The architect and I went over there prior to the meeting of all these people back a few days ago. He got to looking at those woods and saw it drops off pretty quick down there, much lower. And I don't know whether the size of this building, whether he's going to have a problem about making space for the parking over there where he's got the little concrete things, you know, where they had been parking at one time next to private property there, kind of up on the far side. I just don't know whether he's going to come back and say it's just going to be a little too close there for the extra drive lane for the people letting the patients off under a shelter, you know. Got to be separate from the other. And then while we were over there, big FedEx truck came up Rudd Street, went zooming right on across there.
Answered
to get to
the question, didn't
yeah.
he?
And so I mentioned to Brian when we first were over there, I said, Brian, it could be, since they may not need all that space, it's on that side, that long side where the houses are, not where the woods are. I said, it could be that if they need more parking there for the people working there at the old county hospital, they can come utilize some of that. But now I don't know how that would work out, really. I don't, you know what I mean? If they come in, you
have to good part, we have some options in that because of us owning that land. So.
Right.
Is this going to be a new building or redoing the old building?
It'll be a new building, brand new, built with Mr. Petrie's funds. To house Open Door Clinic and Prince of Adult Day and some DSS services and family abuse services. And then if there's any, Mr. Petrie has committed up to $3 million, $2.5 million toward this building, and then possibly another $500,000 toward the Mental Health Diversion Center. That'll be a renovation. That's the Elderly Services building that's over behind the Ag building.
Yeah.
So ACTA's in there right now. I think they're moving out in the next week or two. And Friendship Adult Day is the last group that's left there. They would move out. At that time, we'd be able to use Mr. Petrie's funding and the $1.2 million we have from Cardinal Innovations to start the renovation of the Elderly Services building. So it's a combination. It's new construction. That's the primary piece. And then some assistance with renovating Elderly Services for diversion.
How about the ongoing cost after that?
That'll be on the county, of course. I don't think we're going to see too much of an uptick in ongoing costs for Elderly Services because we're already operating that building. In fact, my hope is it'll become more efficient once we get some of the antique heat and air stuff that's in there out.
So are you saying that the county is going to have to fund everything except for the building, the maintenance?
Yes, we will pay for utilities and maintenance of the new building once it's done. But both groups that we have in our buildings now, Open Door Clinic and Friendship Adult Day, they pay us rent. So they would continue to pay to help offset those utility costs. So there would be some cost to the county, I imagine, for operating the new facility. But the good news to me is Friendship Adult Day and Open Door Clinic are already tenants of county properties now. They've been excellent tenants. They both pay their rent and their utilities on time, every time. So I think we would look forward to continuing that relationship. So I think it would be, they would help us offset a good portion of the operating costs.
It's now in the construction process. I guess we will go, the county will oversee that. Is that correct? I mean, I know it's your money, but we will be over the day-to-day construction.
Yes, with Mr. Petrie's assistance, he's very interested in the design and the planning process, too. We welcome his input. I know I spoke with the county manager in Stokes County, and he spoke very highly of Mr. Petrie, and his involvement in that project in Stokes helped it become a really good, high-quality project. So we'd certainly encourage Mr. Petrie to stay connected to the project. Mr. Albright's been working on legal ways to facilitate this to happen on trusts, and we'll also have a contract with Mr. Petrie that is not prepared today, but I'll bring it back to the board for your review and to approve. But it'll be one that the county and Mr. Petrie agree on. We'll also have to put out an RFP for an architect to select someone, and I think that will be the next few things that you'll hear about from us in the very near future.
This is exciting.
Yes, indeed.
Today's for information and just a consensus from the board, not for a vote, correct?
Yes, I think at this point, you know, we've been talking with Mr. Petrie for a while about what fits both of our visions, county government and Mr. Petrie, and this is what we've come up with. So we felt like we were at a point to bring it to the board and just get consensus that you're comfortable with us moving forward with Mr. Petrie and moving forward with Mr. Albright working with him.
Mr. Byrd, I'm sure you have some things.
No, I think this
questions.
Is exciting. No,
yeah, it's exciting.
I want to see the, so make sure you build this new building as efficiently as you can so we have more money to put towards the diversion center.
And hopefully your stocks will maintain.
They're about gone. I don't have any. And when this goes to the county, she'll be about broke.
Mr. Petrie, my condolences on the passing of your sister in January. And thank you for your service in Vietnam. Appreciate that very much. Vietnam veterans are a special generation. If you have any suggestions or investment advice, we can get together for lunch. I'll buy.
Brian probably knows because I gave him a copy of my sister's last brokerage statement. and it showed in there. See, I forgot again where I am. How bad I'm getting. Looked at her statement.
We were thinking about the investment advice.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. Sometimes I'll forget right then again, the second time. But this time
too.
I believe I remember. Now I'm forgetting.
Well, we are so delighted that you were here today.
Wait a minute, just give me another second. Well, no, it's not coming. But anyway, if there's no other questions, I want to close by saying this, by giving thanks to where I think thanks is due, and that's both to Brian and Susan. You can thank them for this really being done, and I say that because they came to my house while my sister was living a number of times to my home. They know I was the only one there. Sometimes hospice would come there or the home health division of hospice at other times. But my sister, she was bedridden for the last 3 years or maybe going on four. I tell you, time goes by, I can't keep up with it. And I have to turn her every so often for the bed sores that were forming and all. She'd have to go to the wound care center periodically and whatnot. So they had to come to me, and I appreciated that. And Brian, he was instrumental in my giving funds for the college. Susan, she's not going to let up at all. She is going to be sure. Now, I'm going to give that I was going to give my property, 12 and a half acres. I like it. It's a real well-built home. It's got a wooded area in the back with huge trees. I mean, they hadn't been cut probably in a long time, with a little stream going down through there to a pond that's in somebody else's property on back behind. But it's about 2,000 feet deep, the property is, from the highway. And I was going to give that. I started off taking my sister to Friendship. She didn't like it. I knew she wouldn't because she's at a stage where she could hardly move around at that point. I should have gotten her over there before. So she didn't stay, just set up for one day a week. Didn't set up to stay too long. And then I talk so much that I lose track. Oh, yeah. Well, so it was set up first that I was going to get to Friendship. And now this new facility is going to work out even better because they want me to tear one of the walls out from the living room to a bedroom. It's a real long ranch-type brick home. And then if she wanted a deck, wanted more restrooms back where there's only so many. And I said, well, what's this going to all cost? And then, too, she didn't want me to deed it to the Friendship. I told her I prefer to do that because I knew then with all those people in there, some with physical disabilities, they're all adults, and some mental incapacity losses, whatnot. I just didn't want it all tore up. And I knew if they owned it, they would probably take better care of it than if the county owned it. But she didn't like that idea. She said she was used to the county making sure they had a good place to stay and all. So that's when I got the idea of maybe finding her maybe something else other than there. But Susan, she's determined that she's going to make sure that I get a good nonprofit to turn the deed over to where I'm living. Now, as to where I'm going, could be when my mother and I moved there in 1982, 83, we built another nice little house back behind, pretty good ways. She said if I ever got married, she'd have a place to go, and then I'd have a place for my wife and whatnot up there. But that never did happen, so we ended up renting it for over 20 years or more. Now it's empty. I redid everything. Looks like brand new inside and out. It's real nice. May live there. May ask for lifetime rights, you know, and then I'll move on. Or if I'm incapacitated where I have to go and which is felt that I can't return back, then they take it over then. So thank Brian. If it wasn't for him, if it had been anyone else, now he was just the assistant county manager then. And then I called Susan, and talked to her on the phone, told her I had been a foster parent one time. I believe you said you had too, one time.
Yes, you? Sir.
Yeah, I remember. That's how many years ago was that been?
That was
when my sister. That's when my sister was still living with me since 2010, and I bugged her about seeing. I told her I was interested in a group using that could be helped. And so instead of selling it to maybe one or two more families using it over a period of time before it demolished it, that this would be more beneficial if many people were given the opportunity to use it. And so she's been working with it ever since, and now it's on a benevolence farm that needs another place for women just getting out of prison to have a place to go and work on the farm for some money. And they're sort of branching in more than just raising things, crops, maybe into crafts, making things, you know, in the winter to sell. They have an outlet to do all of this. Don't know how it's going to work out, but I'm considering it. I've been down there and looked it over. It's about 9 miles from where I live, down on the Bass Mountain Road. You turn off of the Bass Mountain Road to the left on the Thompson Mill Road, I believe. Yeah, it's on down that way where they're located, that they have about 13 acres, I think. But a lot of it goes downhill to where it's not good for agriculture, so forth. So if it had been anyone else at that time, instead of Brian or Susan, this might not have happened. I might end up maybe doing more up at Stokes County.
Well,
I've got some funds left, but what I've got left, if I don't trickle a little bit in where they might need it here to do both of these things, would be up there in Stokes County.
Well, Mr. Petrie, we just can't tell you enough how much we appreciate your generosity and your vision, and just you. You're just wonderful. And well, it's a delight to get to finally meet you today.
Right.
I've heard so many glowing and wonderful things about you. Okay. They speak as good about you behind your back as you speak in front of them. So we are just thrilled that you're here today. I would lead everyone in a standing ovation if I didn't think you would not like it, that you would scowl at me. So we won't do that, but we just, from the bottom of our hearts, we can't tell you thank you enough for looking after people in this county, and thousands and thousands and thousands of people will be served and have no idea that it started with you today, but we know.
Yeah, this a walk-in clinic, an open door clinic, I like the idea. I'd like, and I know I won't see the day, where all people have their medical help taken care of them from womb to tomb, so to speak. Now, that may be a long time off, but I believe it's going to happen eventually, and that's my thoughts on that. I don't know what all is going to have to take place before it comes to that.
A lot of things.
But I believe it will, and you may disagree, but I just can't help think it. For this earth to survive, it's going to have to be something like that, because there's so many religious wars, wars between different countries. Everybody's got their own military. My thoughts on that is sort of like a the different countries coming together and say, well, let's combine everything into one world government. Now, you may not like that idea, different from what we have had, where they've got to say so in what changes need to be made. Voting rights according to the population of the country or whatnot, but only one military. That way you don't have all the countries spending money to, you know, to safeguard themselves. All that military does is to keep down any kind of things that doesn't go right, maybe in certain areas. But if the countries have a say-so to make improvements as time goes on, then you can take care of everybody's self that way, I believe.
Sir.
And if that doesn't happen, in my opinion, this world's not too many years off in the going.
Yes, sir. Well, clearly, if everybody had your heart, we wouldn't have to worry about anything.
Wouldn't need a military.
But anyway, I want to hang on and stay a little longer. I want to hear some of these other things because I'm interested in some of the other discussions.
Well, you are more than welcome to, and please come back anytime. And we actually look forward to it. Thank you so much. What a pleasure. Mr. Vipperman, you're up next on the agenda.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the board. So I've come today to talk about a potential community paramedic program, and I'll explain exactly what a community paramedic program is and what they do as we go through. So I have a brief PowerPoint presentation that I'd like to go through. So as I said, we're proposing the establishment of a community paramedic program. This has been something that we've talked about since I've got here. And just to give you some idea, one of my pre-interview questionnaire questions was, if you didn't have any county funding, how would you create a community paramedic program? So it's been something that Alamance EMS has been thinking about for a while. So we were approached by Triad Healthcare Network probably back in July, sometime around. And they came to us and told us about a program they were doing with Guilford County EMS and having a lot of success. And they were very anxious to have conversations about expanding it into Alamance County as well. So that was something that I wanted to do. So worked closely with Dr. Qualley, our medical director. And we've had a lot of meetings, and we think we're at the point to where we're ready to press forward with your approval. So Triad Healthcare Network is just an accountable care organization, physician-led, and they focus mostly on Medicare patients. The program will be funded in its entirety by Triad Healthcare Network, and this is through money saved by targeting high-risk readmission patients to prevent their readmission in the hospital, so that creates a whole lot of savings, so they're able to fund us that way. And initially, we begin with one community paramedic, but depending on growth and demand, that can quickly turn into two or more. So just a little background on community paramedicine. It's also known as mobile integrated healthcare. It just kind of takes, it's a new buzzword in the business or the industry. It just takes the paramedic out of their traditional 911 responder role and puts them more in a traditional healthcare role. Visits are performed in patients' houses, so you're actually able to see their whole environment, to whereas physicians are kind of limited. They only get to see these folks in their offices. The community paramedics offer eyes inside a home, so they're able to see the whole environment. In our program, the community paramedic would work in conjunction with the supervising physician that Cone Health and ARMC would be providing. This is going to be initially one of the heart failure physicians with the LaBauer group, I believe. And just for clarification, community paramedics augment, but they don't replace home health care, so there's no competition with home health care. We're serving really a different role. And a lot of times, community paramedics are able to respond even if there's insurance issues or anything like that. So just a little bit more background. In 2014, THN, Cone Health, and Guilford County EMS partnered together and began a program there. And you can see on the left, they looked at the paramedicine participants. And you'll notice that they had a 53% reduction in the admit rate post-program, so 3 months post-program, to whereas their controls that they used, which was a similar patient population, actually had an increase in readmission. So when folks get readmitted, especially Medicare folks, for any reason, that you get a very stiff penalties. So just to give an idea of what paramedic home visits are, and I actually went a day and rode with Guilford County, Guilford County's community paramedic program, just to get a better feel. But it's things as simple as just taking vital signs. A lot of it is medication reconciliation, filling pill boxes. So the person that I rode with would actually, if she went once a week or once every 2 weeks, she would actually fill morning, noon, midday, night medications for each of the days in between her visits, just to make sure that these patients were taking the medications that they were supposed to take, which can make a really big deal. Educate regarding heart failure home recommendations. They look at diet, you know, they'll look in refrigerators, make sure that folks are eating kind of a healthier diet, make sure that they've got food, and if not, we'll work with other folks to make sure that they get that. If there was some somebody was showing signs of congestive failure, had fluid in their lungs or something, you could even administer IV Lasix in the home after you talk to the physician and maybe prevent them from having to go to the emergency room later on down the road. They even have a vest that they use that Triad Healthcare Network would be providing us that actually goes on the patient's right lung and can actually tell you the percentage of fluid inside that lung to tell you if they're in failure or not. And so they try to do real-time problem resolution when feasible for these patients and hopefully save them trips to the emergency room or readmission to the hospital. So how our program would work? Initially, we would meet these folks in the clinic, in the heart failure clinic, to get introduced to them. And then after that, we'd make periodic visits in the home, and that would kind of work with the ARMC heart failure team, which we're currently working with them to form. And so that'll consist of the community paramedic, myself and Dr. Qualley, a heart failure nurse, a nurse navigator, the supervising physician, clinical social worker, the Triad Healthcare Network program manager, and then any others that would be pertinent, and actually discuss these cases to see what needs to be done, what other resources need to be employed to help these folks out. So how it'll work, we would hire the community paramedic from our existing personnel, and we would, we're working on trying to figure out what our minimum qualifications, working with other community paramedic programs now to determine those. Once we hired that individual, they would participate in about a 4 to 6 week training program. So their 40 hours a week would be spent in CIT training, in the heart failure clinic, of course, riding with other community paramedics, even doing things as simple as nutritional training, you know, label reading, that type of thing, to make sure that they can educate these patients, and then working with the heart failure vest that we would get. And so just a little bit of background on why we're initially focusing on heart failure. Well, one reason is that's the Guilford County model, so Triad Healthcare Network is most familiar with that. But heart failure has some significant implications if not treated. You see 4% of folks with acute heart failure die during their hospitalization, 10% die within 30 days, greater than 20% die within 180 days of the event, approximately 30% would die within a year of an acute heart failure event, and that's what you're trying to prevent through this program, and then approximately 50% would die within 5 years. And these are numbers from Cone Health, from one of their PowerPoint presentations. So if we can get in these patients' homes and we can keep them managed and prevent that acute event from happening, then these folks will have a lot better outcome and a lot more longevity. This program could expand. Again, we're going to start following the Guilford County model, but that doesn't mean we're going to stay there. So we could see an expanse with COPD-type patients, patients with any kind of heart disease, mental health patients, in touch with the Stepping Up initiative, and then renal failure patients even, just helping these folks manage, because what you're trying to prevent are those acute emergent situations where they're back in the hospital. So talk about funding. THN has agreed to assist in starting up the program with some startup cost. The exact amount of that we'll have to work out during the contract negotiation process, which of course we'll work with county management and county legal in doing that. The way the program is sustained is THN provides $250 per month per enrolled patient. So it doesn't matter how many times you see a patient in a given month. So at the beginning, you might see them four or five times in a month, but towards the end, you may only be seeing them one time a month. So it kind of balances out. So when we looked at what our break even would be, we would have to hire a new paramedic to replace the person that we would be moving to the community paramedic. And that's approximately $4,500 per month salary and benefits. And so you can see our break even point would be 18 patients for that community paramedic enrolled. And talking with THN in Guilford, it is possible to have as many as 30 patients per community paramedic. So you can see how it goes. After 18 patients, we start to become profitable. And you can see if we were able to go up to 20 patients, and that's a big if, you know, we would just have to see how the program was going. Then we could potentially be running a profit, hopefully that we could use for future growth in the program. But we do feel like that all of the cost will be covered by THN. If for whatever reason the program was to fail, and of course we had added a position, we do want you to know that we've thought about an exit strategy, and we would hope that there would be enough funding left in the program to cover that salary of that individual until we had a vacancy within the department. And generally we have vacancies, so I don't think that would be a really big deal. And at that point, we would just ask that individual be transferred back into their former position on an ambulance, and we would just lose that position after that. Not that we think we're going to have to use this, but we did just want to bring this forward. And so here's what we're requesting today. We are requesting the approval to pursue a contract with Triad Healthcare Network and Cone Health / ARMC to begin a community paramedic program in Alamance County. Again, we'll be working with county legal and county management on that contract. Should the contract get signed by both parties, we would ask to be able to hire to add the position of a community paramedic, so a net gain of one FTE in our department. And then the final request would be that we would utilize any excess funds that the program generates for future growth of the program. This is something that I've talked with Susan about, the idea of having just a separate account for the community paramedic program, which that individual could be paid out of. And that way all of that money goes toward future growth, because if we, even with the startup funding that THN might give, there's a lot of equipment cost. You've got to put this individual in a vehicle. It's something that we were able to absorb, we'll be able to absorb for the first one, but probably not as easily for the second one and subsequent. So we would need that money. Not to mention just the salary cost of that first 4 to 6 weeks when they're not seeing patients and they are being trained. So with that, I'll take any questions that you might have.
I'd like to make a couple of supporting remarks. So I first heard of EMTs and EMS departments doing this broader role in the community at a Commissioners Association meeting. And I can't remember the county. I'm thinking it was a county in the eastern part of the state, or maybe Cabarrus County. I'm not sure. There are other counties.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah.
And it sounded really interesting. And just a comment about THN. So that's the Triad Healthcare Network, which is generically referred to as an accountable care organization, because of Cone Health's entry into this that made Cone Health very attractive for us to merge with at Alamance Regional. And it's really population health at its best, because it's doing things well. So the Triad Healthcare Network is essentially a collection of providers, so some of them are home health physician practices and the hospital itself and other providers in the Cone Health Network, and others are just private providers who come together to figure out how to manage population health, because so that the, you know, the best care is being given at the proper location, the most cost-effective place, with the intention of not only improving the health of the population, but keeping people out of the expensive part of the healthcare system. And then they, then that Triad Healthcare Network is, pays for that by saving money in having these at-risk contracts, either with insurance companies, or Cone Health has a relationship with their own insurance company. They provide a Medicare Advantage program, and they participate in the Medicare Shared Savings Program. So any money that's saved in any of those products inure to the benefit of Cone Health, but that enables them to use that money to pay for services that otherwise normally aren't covered by insurance, you know, commercial or typical insurance. So that's why it's the Cone Health's best interest to do this with our EMTs. And it's just, it's a win-win for everybody. So I think it's a great program.
Yeah, I can't see where we have a loss coming into doing this modeling.
Right.
I mean, it looks to be a positive thing, especially for the citizen. I had a mother that was on so many medications, and she had heart failures and this, that, and the other, and just having a person to come in and sit in their environment and helping them with their medication, because it's complicated when you get into that, and you got 12 different medications, yeah, and you're trying to figure, what am I supposed to take today? And I can see where that's a big advantage.
Okay, so we'd be seeking a motion to approve pursual of a contract with THN and Cone Health, approving hiring one full-time community paramedic, and approve using the excess funding for future growth of this program. Is that?
Yes, ma'am.
Adequate.
Sums it up.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
Great. We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. Mr. Haygood, looking at the remainder of the agenda, it is 12 o'clock. We've been at it for 3 hours, and we do need to go into closed session. Of the remaining items on the agenda, is there anything that you could recommend us table? If not, then that's fine. I just thought I would ask.
I would recommend the board table item 5, 6, and 7. So it would be the trade in of property, park naming policy, and the decision about demolishing the South Annex.
What about 8?
Yeah, what happened?
I think 8, my understanding is 8 should be fairly short.
Very short.
And if it's not, then we can table that too.
That's fine.
If it turns out.
I want to table that as well.
I would like to go ahead and get that one kicked out.
Shall I come up now?
Well, we need to have a motion.
I'll make a motion that we table the 5, 6, and 7 until a later date.
Second.
Great. We have a motion and a second on tabling those three items: the approval to trade in surplus policy, the parks and rec naming policy, and then a discussion about the South Annex demolition. Is there any discussion on that? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Great. Thank you, Mr. Albright.
With all the economic development projects we have going on, we've got people running for county office that may or may not have a claim against county. I suggested to the chair that perhaps maybe it's time to expand our definition of financial interest on the ethics policy. It appears on the bottom of page 7. The topic is avoiding voting on matters involving your own financial interest or financial conduct. And it requires you to disclose the existence of direct financial interest in advance, and if you're in doubt, obtain an opinion from your local attorney about whether you must vote or may be excused. And added to that is such financial interest shall include a direct or indirect benefit to your employer, because it could be that someone is running for county office that's a employee of Sheetz, a Walmart, and may bring an incentive package to this board, and they would have to recuse themselves. But this would allow them or direct them to avoid voting on that matter if they have any doubt, whether it's a direct or indirect interest to their employer, to seek legal counsel.
So it wouldn't necessarily make it a conflict of interest. It would be just allow them to declare that so they...
Yes. It would point them in the direction of getting a legal opinion, which I think would be better for us all.
What if it was the county attorney's opinion that it was a conflict of interest and the board member should recuse themselves, but the board member refused to do that?
Well, under our policy, we could... the policy talks about that, about the other members of the board determining that it is conflict, that they should recuse themselves from voting. And then it kicks into the censure proceedings, page 4. Hopefully we'd never arrive at that. But the board, the remaining board members would open up an investigation to determine if the ethics have been impugned.
So as long as it's not compelling somebody to recuse themselves. Going to school board meetings, I remember there are two school board members who are employed by Elon University, and somebody was challenging them that voting on the issue of the university building a new school for the school board so that they could take advantage of the old Elon Elementary School's property, and that was going to benefit the university. And,
right.
And to me, that really wasn't a conflict of interest, and they were being challenged, but the challenge didn't hold up.
What was the board's attorney's position on that? The school board attorney, did he support?
I don't remember if he opined on that or not. But it wasn't. I don't know. I didn't see the conflict of interest in that particular example. But so I guess I just wanted to be sure that if something like that came up here, it wasn't going to.
If that's not a conflict of interest, I don't know what is. If you're on the school board and you receive something for your employer, and that's not a conflict of interest, how ridiculous is that?
Well, we're not.
They're going to benefit from receiving that.
Well, no private individual is benefiting. Actually, the community was going to benefit from
their employer is.
Well, we're not faced with that exact situation today. Are there any other questions or comments about revising the code of ethics? Does anybody want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion that we do that. I'm fine with that.
Thank you, Eddie. Anybody want a second?
I'll second that.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you. Okay, so Health Department budget amendment.
Good afternoon. Hopefully this will be pretty quick. So what you have in front of you is a budget amendment in the amount of $10,000 from Impact Alamance to the Health Department. We had an original grant that was presented and approved by the Board of Commissioners in August of 2017. And then the Health Department was approached by the funder and Community Connections, which is a group of local providers trying to align themselves in best practices to offer the same training and resources to the pediatric offices who are serving teens and young women who may be using their pediatrician's office as a primary care provider. And so that's what this grant is. It's an expansion of that original in the amount of $10,000 to provide training and resources to pediatric offices that want to participate. It is a foundation grant, so no local match.
I move approval.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve this budget amendment. Is there any more discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Mr. Haygood, do you have a manager's report?
I do not.
Do we have any commissioner comments?
I had just one, and we got beat up a little bit in the Times News over the weekend about not funding the Allied Churches. And it sounds like they're in a pretty desperate situation. I was going to ask our manager if he has any creative ideas about how to respond if it's everybody else's wish.
Maybe one thing that would be helpful is maybe for me to arrange a meeting with the executive director. I know he's come to several of our board meetings, but I've never had some personal FaceTime with him. So maybe if I had opportunity to just meet with him,
some of our finance folks and talk with them a little bit about what's going on with them. I'll make sure we understand where they're at and what they're facing.
So he came a meeting or two ago and presented a nice PowerPoint presentation, and I know he asked for, I didn't get the idea he was asking us to make a budget change to provide that funding right then and there, but it sounded like maybe that's what he was doing, and we really didn't respond. Nobody made a motion or anything.
It's not the county's responsibility to be in all these things. The county does not need to be involved in that. I hope they get their money to keep that place open. It's worthwhile. But the taxpayers of Alamance County does not need to be funding that particular item.
And I would say to the board, I think we've been very reluctant to open up for the past two budgets to new outside agencies for funding. We had found a way to work with them through DSS that didn't cost additional county dollars. So if the board agrees, I don't mind meeting with Mr. Gary and just trying to see where are they and is there some other options we can help them think about for funding.
And that's what I'm asking.
Do any of the municipalities give them any money?
I'm just not sure.
I'd like to see that, number one, and I'd like to see the complete financials if we're going to get involved in any review of this. I want to know salaries. I want to know everything. And
it's available.
Yeah. It's got to be there.
I'm sure, yes.
I would just say if they stop providing service, that's going to end up costing the taxpayers in other ways. And in some counties, I've mentioned this before, that the counties take on the responsibility of providing homeless shelters. So it's not an unprecedented thing to support.
Before we go, I got to tell this quick. It won't take 30 seconds. I was at the library years ago. This guy came. I used to sit down and talk about how to look for a job and so on. He looked at me one day. He said, "What's wrong with y'all's jail?" I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "They don't have any TVs." He said, "Down in Hillsboro, they got TVs in Orange County." And I said, "Well, go down there and throw a rock through a window."
And you accomplished.
Then you'll get to watch Andy Griffith. I swear, that's a true conversation. We got TVs now?
Yeah, they're not going to go down there and throw a rock.
All right, so I have a motion. I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11 sub A sub 3 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners.
I'll second that, ma'am.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you.
On the way. Reconvene.
Anybody second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second to reconvene an open session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. We have met and consulted with the county attorney and considered and given him instructions on the handling of a claim made against Alamance County. So all other business being concluded, we're adjourned.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.